welcome to Weekly Affirmations, our first Thursday show. We're so happy to be here. It's not quite the weekend yet, but we're still pretty positive. And we are feeling super great about this week. I'm a little bit sick and a little bit drugged up, so if I seem a little bit loopy, that's okay. But I think, Laura QQ, you should start us out with our theme song.
Oh, I said a weekly affirmations, a positive feel-good show.
Sometimes.
The most positive thing on this channel called Hyper Rabbit Power Go.
It's pretty decent.
Oh, welcome to the primetime slot thumpers.
Yeah.
We're super glad to be here. Oh, look at everybody. Demolition, Final Fantasy IX Master. Yeah. Empty Nocte. So we are super glad to be here on this awesome Thursday night. We have moved the show permanently to the slot, so it will be at 6 p.m. on Thursdays, PST, every time from now on. We're super excited about that. I am the host of the show, Strix, and this show, Weekly Affirmations, is about freeform and indie RPGs and our exploration thereof. So we play all kinds of games on the show that are analog, with all kinds of mechanics, including cards, fire one time, that was fun, screaming, mirrors, all kinds of stuff. So this is a really fun show, I really enjoy putting it on, and this week is very special because this is the finale of Bluebeard's Bride. Which is a tabletop game which is currently on Kickstarter. I happen to know this because I am one of the designers. Yay!
We gotta take a second to clap for that one.
So Bluebeard's Bride is a feminine horror game. It's powered by the apocalypse, meaning it bases itself off the apocalypse world rule set, though we've kind of taken liberties with that. And it is about the fairy tale of Bluebeard, only from the bride's point of view. So in this game, the players play parts of the bride's psyche as they try to figure out what is going on with Bluebeard, and as they are eternally drawn to that last room in the fairy tale where they find the dead bodies of all the previous wives. That's not a surprise. So you should be aware that this show today, specifically, is gonna have maybe some adult content, sexual content, violence. So if those are things that you're not cool with, hey, that's awesome. We just wanted to let you know. We are also playing with the X card today. The X card is a mechanic that we love around here. Yeah. And this is our safety mechanism for saying, nope, not that thing. So we're all familiar with the X card, right? We're all comfortable
with it? Oh yeah.
Cool. So I have explained it a million times. You can go check out the other VODs for that. We're gonna save some time today. One other change that I wanna mention today for the show going forward is that reruns.
Say what? Money. I would like to affirm drunk lie romantic for all the reasons. All
of the reasons. Oh, thank you. Mwah. Paladin Hulk.
So that was from Paladin Hulk to Drunkly Romantic. So on this show, we do affirmations, which is super great. We pull them from our handy dandy affirmation matrix so that you can feel awesome throughout the rest of your week. I was just about to say resubs are no longer going to get affirmations going forward. However, new subs and donations of at least $5 will. So would you like your affirmation, sir?
Oh, I would love it.
Okay. Let's see what we got here today. Yes, yes. All right. So, Drunkly, you are sensational, amusing, sugar.
Oh, washing over me. That was amazing. Mm-hmm. What would that sound like?
That's your job.
Oh, jeez. I thought it would work if I just said, like, no. What was it again?
Sensational, amusing, sugar.
Ha! That's where I'm at with
there
it.
There weren't even any tentacles there.
Well, these are the tentacles!
Okay,
these
okay.
are the tentacles! Right, come the on! Tentacles. Don't critique my
tentacle
really skills.
Impressive
just because it's not a bathtub, okay?
Well done.
Who's that? Wigglypin! Thank you for following. So, we're gonna do the thing that we normally do with serious games. We're gonna shut down the sounds for affirmations when we start playing. So if you wanna get those in, do those now, or you'll have to wait to the end of the show to get them right out. You can always subscribe or donate anytime during the show, but the affirmations happen at the beginning and at the end. So I think we should probably summarize where we've been up to this point, a little bit about the game, and then kind of just get into playing. Does that sound good to you guys?
Yeah.
They're all looking at me like.
Oh.
Subscriber.
Oh, dance time. Welcome to subscriber.
wonderful things.
Joy and happiness.
Wait, wait. So who subscribed? We got too excited. Well, who subscribed?
Chat, please help us.
One more time.
Money. Welcome to Thursday's Strix and All. Yay. Looking forward to what is in store tonight. Affirmation for Strix for healing. Hashtag Wilsing.
Thank you.
Some penicillin.
Oh, yes, some penicillin. I see what you did there.
Lovely.
All right, so welcome to the Thumper family, some penicillin.
Oh. Money. Please affirm Strix consort, though he looks different today. Did he get a haircut?
That's me.
Yep.
Hello.
This is what shattered consort looks like.
Yeah. It's weird that it kind of looks like drunkly.
Yeah. It's a transformation.
All right, so penicillin, this one is for you. You are a proud, enchanting chinchilla. Oh. So that would be like,
that was absolutely enchanting, yeah.
Yep, just like that.
And rather proud as well.
Yep, totally proud. So that is your affirmation. And if you're wondering what an affirmation is, I think I just illustrated, it is silly sounds and animals.
Yeah.
And sometimes magical.
Pray that someone gets an anteater.
Oh, oh yes.
Pray that no
I
want to
hear what the sick anteater, the sick anteater sounds like.
Sick anteater probably sounds like it's a dag.
Done, gone forever.
Is Gollum one of the options?
Oh, it should be. It should be. Okay, so the next affirmation is actually for me. That's so nice, from Aridin. So, I am a maniacal, abiding panda. A maniacal, abiding panda. I feel like someone else should make the sound for me.
I do too.
Cheryl always comes through.
The Cheryl abides.
Absolutely. All right, and the next one is for you, Drunkly. Consort.
Consort romantic. Drunkly. Something.
Okay. All right, so this is from Meriden.
Okay.
You are an inquisitive, exploding dragon. Pretty good.
Yeah, that's really good. Should I do it or should I give someone else?
I think you should do
okay.
it.
Okay. Michael Bay.
Are there helicopters?
Yeah, there's helicopters. Sunsets. Reusing the same shots from three movies. Yeah.
Well done.
That's excellent. Super
so,
excellent.
I'm seeing something in chat that says that, is this true that guests on Weekly Affirmations get to write their own card?
Yep. So at the end of today's show, you're going to be able to add a card to the deck.
And that's why I permanently damaged the deck with, I shattered the deck by adding Sharktopus in there.
Yep.
That was my fault, guys. Sorry.
There is a Sharktopus.
I am so
excited. That bounce roll adds a salty card.
Oh, salty. Yes.
Because
yeah,
she would.
Yeah. 90% salt
awesome.
That one. Love that person.
I don't have to think about that. But it is supposed to be affirming.
Yes.
Affirming cards.
Mm-hmm.
Salt is
I'm
positive.
I'm affirmed by salt. Salt is necessary.
It doesn't
for
salt,
life.
Is a, salt is a positive
it's,
charge, right?
It makes things taste good. It's a sign
exactly.
that loves us and wants
yes.
to eat food.
Yes.
Yes. Salt is very affirming. Good job, Bronze.
Yes.
Hi, Tahoots. Hi, Mom.
Aww. Hi, Cheryl's mom.
Hello again, you please.
We're about to do terrible things.
Yep, sorry.
We've had the talk.
All right, so let's talk about Bluebeard's Bride. So Bluebeard's Bride is
kind of
money.
Yeah, money.
Money. An affirmation for the panel of host and guests.
Aww.
Welcome to Thursday, this Strix.
Thank you, affirmer.
So this is for all of us.
We all have to make the sound
yep,
at the same time.
Yeah.
The exact same time.
Yes.
Okay.
This is perfect. So we are all melodic, blushing pythons.
Ooh.
Oh. Alright
then.
Ready? One, two, three.
Slay! I'd like an affirmation for my wife, whom I love, Dee.
Yes. Tahood's.
Aww.
Does she have a name, Tahood's?
Yeah.
I can call her
wife
instead of Tahood's wife? Just curious.
It's like Strix consort. Tahood's wife.
I think it's
Ms. Hoods.
Ms. Hoods.
Ms. Hoods.
Ms. Hoods. All right, Tahoods, I would love to affirm your wife, who you cook for often.
Yes.
Don't think I forgot that.
And so, today is, or was it yesterday, that cook for, husbands cook for, I saw it on Sarah Michelle Gellar's Twitter.
It has to be something.
you should, national holidays national, as defined by Sarah Michelle Gellar's Twitter.
National. Husbands cook dinner day or something.
We need a date for Freddie that.
Prince Jr.
I know, but you know.
Kim.
People right, do.
Kim.
Oh, Kim. Excellent. Kim. So Kim, this one is for you. It's from Tahoods, your loving, loving husband. And you are an effulgent analyzing genie.
Effulgent.
I'm learning a lot of
adjectives. That's fantastic, right?
How does that one?
I would assume Sally or something.
Bam, right
yeah.
here.
So, Mel.
Yeah, one more time.
Effulgent analyzing genie.
Can you tell me what effulgent means?
I'm gonna let you guess.
Oh. Yeah, it needs to come through in your sound.
Oh God.
You know it. We'll know for sure that you don't
Listen,
know what it
I
means.
I have a great vocabulary.
Sounds kind of bubbly.
Yeah, so, Kim. This one's breaking me. Like, Sharktopus is fine, Anteater is fine, and I'm like, genie, shit.
Shattered now.
So, tell me more about that.
I think that's perfect. Good. That's wonderful.
Good. Oh, dude.
Oh, man.
Tell me all of your needs.
Yeah. Perfect.
Effulgent, like glowing. Trying to remember.
I'm gonna look it up later.
My favorite thing is that when we like, when we try to get down to like, okay, so let me tell you about the story. Dun, 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 dun. Like, every time, like, we didn't get that. We did that. What was the game? Ryutama.
Yeah.
And we didn't get to do anything with that. That was amazing.
We did. We did,
but it was like 40 minutes into every episode.
Money. This is my first time watching one of these streams, and so I am excited to watch.
Hi, we're
sending much love and affirmations to Marcus.
Oh, thank you. Oh my gosh.
Thanks,
Toasty Ghosty. Mwah. Oh, Jim, yes. How you doing?
Jesus Christ. Thanks for the bits, Mr. Owl. Okay, so
did we already miss?
Okay.
So you are an assertive, astonishing salamander.
Is that what?
The magical kind.
Okay, the magical kind. Okay.
Fire spirits.
That's what I got right now. That was good,
yes,
right? Thank
yes,
you.
Yes.
Please clap.
Please clap. Very good, sir. Very good.
Yes. Someone said a fulgent is someone who just had a good dinner with himself and his wife. Well played, Carlin.
Thank you. Thank you.
So I think, as I was saying, Bluebeard's Bride is a tabletop role-playing game. It's a story game. And it is for 2 to 5 players. And it is a one-shot game, meaning you play it, and then you play it again with replay value. And I think, as we've discussed before, there's a lot of replay value in this game.
I would imagine just different for different characters.
Yeah,
there's gotta be a lot.
There's no way you can really play the same game twice, mm-hmm. as far as kind of character generation goes, and just going into the rooms and how they're generated. Like, I've never played the same game of Bluebeard's Bride twice, so that's super awesome. This game was designed by myself, I'm the Strix, and Marissa Kelly and Sarah Richardson. It took us about 2.5 years. We started this game kind of on a whim at a game jam. We'd never met each other before. So this is remarkable from start to finish. The game is currently kickstarting. I'm sure someone in chat can share the link. We had a goal of $5,000 for this game.
And how far over that have you
gone? Yeah.
I think as of like 2 hours ago, it was at...
How much?
It was at $80,000. So I'm having a hard time adjusting to reality.
Yeah, all of them have to be gold now. I just have to be gold crusted.
So the game is crushing it, and it's being really well received, and that feels very good. And we were surprised, but we're also very happy because this game is a gothic feminine horror. It's a specific genre that exists everywhere else in literature and movies, but there's never actually been a tabletop game in this genre before. So we're really happy to bring it forward. We're happy, $80,304. There we go. and we hope that, you know, people play this game and really enjoy it. And also that it makes them think about what you can do in games a little bit differently. So We really love it, and we think you will too. And the art is beautiful.
Yes.
The art is beautiful.
It's frustratingly beautiful.
Like, just go to the Kickstarter to look at the art. You don't have to do anything else. Just look at it.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's amazing. It's amazing.
So good.
So we're in the middle, actually, the last third of our campaign this week. We have Drunkly Romantic sitting in for Strix consort. He is actually at a conference on the East Coast, so you couldn't be here. But we're going to summarize, I think, really quickly kind of what's been going on, and then we're going to just jump to it. So one of the benefits of having one of the designers in the studio, guys, is that you can ask me questions. So feel free to ask questions in chat, to comment on the game. If I don't answer it, maybe because I just didn't see it the first time. So every once in a while, if you haven't had your question answered, you feel free to repeat it. Just don't spam. And then have fun. There's lots of other people in chat that are really cool. I see some of my favorite peeps, so say hi to them. And I think we'll get started with talking about what's going on, if that sounds good to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So in this game of Bluebeard's Bride, the bride is a young woman who, and I'm gonna let Lizzie describe how she looks.
One second while Lizzie flips to that part of her notes.
Long black hair.
Yes, so she has long black hair, very thick, has a certain kind of rose that grows indigenously woven into her hair, though right now...
Maybe went a little too far.
I mean, she's got one.
Right now when the virgin shattered, she stuffed a lot of thorny roses into our hair, and so we're kind of bleeding and messed up right now. She is also quite tall, especially for a woman in her society, and rather plump. She has berry stained lips and smoky brown eyes that she often emphasizes by rimming them in coal.
Excellent. Which, could you tell us about her relationships up until this point?
So, she, like with other people, so she has kind of a adversarial relationship with her mother. She loves her little brother very much and is taking care of him, and she will miss him very much now that she is married and carted away to her new life. She, I believe between us decided, is slightly distrustful of her husband, but overall thinks that it will be a better life than she would have had in her village.
Excellent. And so, Cheryl, or Fatal, can you tell us a little bit, just in brief summary, about the gifts that were given to Bluebeard when you got married?
Yes, so on the night before the wedding, or the last time we saw our husband, before he became our husband, there was a handcrafted necklace gifted by the witch, which part of the bride's psyche. It was sort of Celtic, sort of like antlers.
Antlers and
woven.
Teeth.
Yeah, teeth. There was a gift from the mother, I believe, of the first wine, of wine? Was
bread.
Pardon?
Bread.
Bread. Yeah. Oh, yes, bread. We also gave a, these are the gifts we got. I'm getting a little confused.
We gave.
Gifts.
Yes. There was handmade bread.
Mm-hmm. This is the game, so.
So what are the gifts that you gave Bluebeard?
Yes. And.
The doll, that was the one.
So there was a gift of special bread from the mother part of the psyche, the necklace of the wolf teeth. There was the tiny doll version of the bride that she had grown up with from the virgin, and from the fatal, what do you get? The guy who's got everything. She washed his feet in a private sort of. Audience.
That was sensual and very creepy.
Very creepy.
Awesome. So the story thus far, since we've started playing, is you really start playing this game at character creation when you form bonds with each other. So the sisters are all part of the same psyche, the same bride, but they're a little independent of each other, like you would argue in your head. those are the voices that are arguing or agreeing sometimes. They have alliances, they have enemies, and they don't always get along. So the Virgin has shattered, which means basically the Virgin has taken too much trauma to continue to stay sane. And at this point, she is only a plague upon her sisters. And there are certain opportunities that she will have to interject horrible things when I ask her to. Mostly when the sisters fail a roll. So don't fail a roll or I'm gonna sick the Virgin.
Oh yeah. Careful. Especially the mom.
And in the apocalypse system, it's so easy to fail a roll.
Just a little easy.
So we haven't yet, which makes me so nervous. Wait, because that is not how the law of averages works out.
We've rolled
kind of
well.
I think we totally box-carded.
I'm not a lucky roller, though, so we're going to see.
And you're the one who ended with the ring, so awesome.
Do I have the ring?
I think it was you, right?
He gave it to you at the end of it. I studied. I did my research.
Oh, no, I gave it to you.
You handed it off.
Did you?
I think because I'm the only one who hasn't had it this round.
Because I created a key. I exited the bedroom.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Left, yes, right. The exit.
So we'll get to that part in just a second. But out of the surviving sisters, at least for right now, could you maybe sum up where your relationships are with each other right now, how you're feeling about each other, and about the bride, and about this house?
So, the witch is shaken at this point. The virgin had always been, as discussed, a tool for the witch to get what she wanted, but didn't realize how much of an effect that the virgin could have on the whole of the being. So it was very troubling for her to watch the descent of the virgin, and the witch is now very hesitant to move forward. So that's where I'm at. Mm-hmm.
So the witch is, the mother rather, is also pretty upset at the moment, despite the fact that the virgin was the one that she had the most friction with. We are all still parts of the same whole, and ultimately her irritation with the virgin came from a place of believing that she needed to be guided more into adulthood from a place of nurturing. There is a bit of guilt that she was not able to save the virgin. As far as her attitude towards the husband, the last token which I took was a token of faithfulness. She saw the spray of our favorite rose in the bedroom as a sign that he had some kind of affection, despite the many horrors that we have witnessed here. because her expectations of the husband of Bluebeard are very tempered, would be a really polite way to put it. So she doesn't hate him. But she's only warmed very, very, very marginally from the kind of neutral that she was at before. Neutral, suspicious that she was at before.
Got it. So I just want to answer a question from chat really quick from Salaskin. So there are 5 playbooks for this game, and clearly we're only playing with 4 today. And the playbook that got left out was the Animus, which is sort of the opposite of the feminine. It's the masculine side. Do you have a question about
that? No, that's just really interesting.
Okay. Because, in psychology, a man would have an anima, a woman has an anima, so we can get into that later. But today we have the virgin, the femme fatale, the mother, and the witch. So the animus is left out, not shattered. Shattering only happens in-game, so if there are any playbooks that get left out, they're just not on the table, so nothing happens with them.
So the fatale, who represents the bride's sexuality, is fairly frustrated. She feels like the virgin became a self-fulfilling prophecy. She refused to think, like, open her mind to what it meant to be ever after. Like, she kept repeating and over, live happily ever after, but never considered that she would have any agency in that or have any responsibilities there. It was just love or not love. At the same time, the first room we entered in our husband's house was a bathroom, where we encountered the head servant, who was a lady named Willa, and she tried to the Fatale tried to get some information out of her, and it escalated quickly.
Yeah, who they murdered by ghost, by the way.
Well, that's
the virgin's fault.
Well, as far as the Fatale's feelings about what happened, we are scared of our own power, and we're scared. We could have gotten much more from that situation had we been willing to yield our power, but instead we had to back away. I mean, we successfully got ourselves out of the bathtub. Yes, we got burned by some bath salts, but the Fatale is frustrated that we're not embracing what little power we have. And feels like she may, and watching the Virgin just spin down the bathtub drain, the Fatale feels like there's less holding her back now. She wanted to help guide the Virgin slowly, but now she's gone, so
she's still here.
It's time to time to take our rightful place in womanhood.
That's scary.
You said something at the end of last week about fairy tales, a quote that I just loved. I was wondering if you could repeat it, if you remembered it.
That fairy tales are gender warfare.
Oh, man.
She essentially, the Virgin was shattered by the story she was told as a child, because they never prepared her for what to do after marriage. It was just like, let her jump off a cliff and see what happens. And that it seems like all the fairy tales that were supposed to give her hope instead put her in a very dark place.
Very, 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 very dark place. So let's talk about what actually happened so far in the game. So we did character creation, we defined the relationships, and we started exploring Bluebeard's mansion, which is big and creepy and has many floors, and time is kind of wobbly. And
bathtubs.
The first room they went into was a bathroom to freshen up. And as you heard, they were cornered by the head servant Mila and sort of preyed upon. Then a giant pewter octopus that was wrapped around the tub started moving. They were doused with an aphrodisiac and ran away. They met a servant, Tristan, who doesn't talk, and we don't know why yet. And they escaped to their bedroom, where they found a room filled with hundreds and hundreds of beautiful, very expensive roses. It's fall, so these had to be horticultured somewhere, probably on the grounds. But there was a substance in the vases mixed with the water, and the room was just filled with this overwhelming sense of grief. The bride tried to claim this as her own room, as a sign of affection and love from Bluebeard, so she went to the closet to put something on because she was not wearing a whole bunch of clothes from the bathroom, and there was a beautiful green dress there that was obviously for someone not her size or height, or it wasn't for her. So the Virgin was kind of tweaking out a little. She took the roses, which she normally puts in her hair, and kind of just smashed them in, thorns and all. And then they found a painting in the back of the closet covered in black cloth. And when they pulled the cloth off that painting, there was a spirit trapped in there, and it was going to hurt them. And so they convinced it to go hurt someone else instead. And that was Mila, the head servant from the bathroom, who they locked in there, by the way.
Yeah.
She tried to kill us. That's fair.
She didn't mean, well, she wasn't trying to kill you. She just was
Just like a little kill? Like
a just like you poisoned the, you a little poisoned the guy.
I mean,
I'm pretty sure this horror killed Mila and now is on the loose and will come and find you again at some point.
Mila can take care of herself, okay?
Maybe not locked in a bathroom with a tentacle.
Take care, I have faith in Mila.
We'll see.
Hashtag Mila lives, is that what we're doing?
The question is, do you want Mila to live after what you've done to her?
No.
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 No. She started it. I don't care.
I kind of do.
Virgin. This is the virgin talking. No.
No trust.
Fine.
So at this point, they are now going to... They're now riled up, right? They clearly feel like something is amiss, and they need to prove to themselves whether Bluebeard loves them or he is actually a terrible, terrible person.
Bluebeard loves us.
Yes, yes, we know, Virgin.
You know, you say that over and over and over.
And so, in case you are forgetting or you're not familiar with how this game works, you explore the rooms to find tokens, and then the players determine and interpret whether those tokens mean love or not love. There is a separate sheet for the bride. Fatal, can you tell us where we're sitting at for tokens right now?
Right now, we are at one of the three tokens of faithfulness and one of the three tokens of disloyalty.
Got it. So one token on each track. They are kept independently. When either one of those hits three tokens, that triggers the final room where the side, the bride just goes, ah, I need to know what is in that final room. And you have a confrontation with it. Oof. There's a separate sheet for that. We all know. Full disclosure, what happens at the end. Usually not good things. Another important thing is our trauma track. So in this game, we have something kind of like hit points. It's called trauma. And when you get five, you shatter, as the virgin found out. What is everyone sitting at right now?
The rest of us have one.
One each.
Ah, because you took a token of faithfulness, which heals trauma. Oh, it's such a wicked mechanic. I'm so happy about
it. I like that a lot, actually.
Okay, so the mother had finished describing a key, which was an obsidian key with, I believe, a flaw or something in the middle that was very
like an insect,
yes,
right?
Yes, like there's an insect, as though it was amber, except it's obsidian, the same way it would be trapped in amber.
Got it. And the sister who has control of the ring right now is the witch. Whichever sister has control of the wedding ring, or the ring of subservience, as we call it, has an extra set of moves. So that ring gets passed around, there are rules about it, and we will explore those as we go. Okay, so, witch, you've got the ring, and you've got this key, and you're gonna go try to find the room that matches with.
Yes.
Okay, so you are coming out of the bedroom, correct?
Yes.
Okay, what does the bride look like right now?
Well, so we got a new dress. That does fit us. So
we're not wearing the green one with the blood on it.
Nope. Correct. But the virgin is. In our mind's eye, the virgin is stuck where she shattered. So, face bloody, hair a tussle, thorny roses stuck in it. While we have, taken some time to braid our hair back, put one rose behind our ear as our token of faithfulness. And then are wearing a blue embroidered dress with, as you described it, embroidery of panicked birds.
In flight, yeah.
it's foreshadowing and we're doing it. so yeah.
That means nothing.
So probably paler than usual, a little stressed, a little nervous. No makeup.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh wait, no, you took one of the berries.
Yeah, so. Basically a handful.
Yeah.
You know, scalp blood is a natural rouge.
Yeah. So I probably smashed up one of the berries and used it for lipstick. Since why not?
It's what you do.
Who knows what we're going to encounter?
Yeah.
Woman's got to look her best.
So you do smear some berry on your lips to give you a little bit of color.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Take one look out of the mirror and go, oh god. And
is her skin still red from being scrubbed so hard?
I mean, it's going to be a little red, but it's not like
glow.
It's a
glow.
Healthy, healthy burning glow.
Healthy wedding night glow.
It's exfoliating. Yeah. It's exfoliating. Great. Doing you a favor. Looking a little haggardly anyway. What are you, 17? It's too old.
Of age, legally.
Yes.
Here. Wherever here.
Oh, what area of the world does this take place in again?
So we're in Turkish-esque area. Okay. We haven't been doing a very good job adhering to that culturally, but we're trying.
Okay. Well, yeah.
So Turkey-esque.
Okay. Turkey-esque.
Turkey-esque.
It's like tofurkey.
Yes.
Let's keep going, shall we?
I go to the thing.
Okay, so you come out into the hallway. Did I mention I'm super drugged up because I'm sick? The hallway. And what time is it now?
Late. it has been, it when we were in the bedroom, it was at least like pitch black mm-hmm. night. So.
Okay, so then it's like mid-morning, actually.
Okay.
I don't know what time you thought it was, but you were wrong. It's mid-morning.
All right. That's fine.
So, windows.
I've got other things to think about other than where the sun is located in the sky, I guess, right now. Right, sisters?
Many more things.
Light streams through the windows onto the plush carpet that leads up to your room, a very deep royal blue. And it stretches a runnered way down the hallway. And as you look out the window, you see that you are on the second floor. And you are going to start exploring. So, are you going to call for a servant or are you going to go on your own? Both are great choices.
I want the nice one.
You want the
Tristan.
Tristan? Oh. I want to call out for him just once mm-hmm. and in like a medium voice. Mhm. Does that count? As a
no.
cry for help?
No, it does okay. not count as a cry for help.
Hooray.
You don't want to cry for help right now.
Nope.
It's not good.
I'm not ready.
May never be.
Okay, so you call out for Tristan. And do you start walking or you just stand there and wait for him?
He dropped us off here, mm-hmm. so I feel like it would be a good idea to be where he left us.
Okay. You wait maybe 2 or 3 minutes, mm-hmm. and nobody shows up.
Okay, I will explore.
Okay. You could yell louder.
No. I don't feel like yelling
okay.
for everyone to hear. That was a that was a hope, and I'm not going to have much of that for long. So let's just go. Let's
check. I've always got to be reasonably safe, right?
Yeah. It's probably not full of, like, death servants or anything. I'm into it. Let's go.
Well, the hallway is actually quite beautiful. On one side is the windows, which are filled with stained glass. And you'll notice that the stained glass is very intricate. Mm-hmm. And there are all different kinds of shapes and scenes in them. One of them actually reminds you very much of the gift that Bluebeard gave you, of your cups. Mm-hmm. You take a look down and you can see, you know, the boar eating the tiger, eating the bear. And it looks like it was done by the same hand, actually.
Great.
Very evocative.
Yay.
Yeah.
It's good he's a patron of the arts.
I think it's beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Let us not linger and find the door which matches this key.
Excellent. So you come to one of the staircases. Do you go up or do you go down?
Sisters, any opinions?
Down is closer to the exit.
Do we want to exit?
I'm not saying we want to exit.
We're not going anywhere. We're staying here.
No one said anything about going anywhere. Mm-hmm.
Down is probably closer to a lot of good things, like there's got to be, you know, a
servants.
Greenhouse,
yes.
Beautiful food. Gardens, food. Yeah, let's go downstairs.
Okay, so you pick up your skirts and you go downstairs.
Mm-hmm.
And you trip. It's just like a little piece of rug that trips you, and you don't fall down, but you and you brace yourself against the side of the wall for a moment. Mm-hmm. And you continue on. And when you get to the bottom floor, there's actually many servants kind of scurrying around, dusting things. They have trays of food. They're going about their daily rituals. Most of them are women.
That apparently means nothing in this house.
Well, it means they're women.
Well, yeah, but
it doesn't protect us under any circumstance.
Nope.
But it also opens up new possibilities.
I think we explored your possibilities with women already in the past day.
Well, you didn't get very
my
far.
My sister. All
but
right.
If you're going to poison the boy who loves us, and
you were totally into it.
Are we really going to have a conversation?
an argument you about something that
with
happened
me with the final outcome
years ago.
That's what
seems
I thought.
A little hypocritical.
So there is one servant who has her head down, and she has a basket full of laundry.
Mm-hmm. What's her hair color?
Beelining it. Why are you ruining my surprises? And she doesn't see you, and she bumps into you. And you both startle, and she looks at you. And she is a lovely, lovely, lovely blonde woman.
What's your name?
Excuse me, madam. I'm so sorry. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What, hello. Good morning. What is your name?
I'm Tula. Madame.
Great.
They're all writing down her name.
Why does that sound like a question?
Yeah. I am so sorry, madame.
Do you know where this key goes? And I'll show her the key.
Oh, that is the master's workroom. It's around the corner and then up the stairs, and then two lefts. It's two lefts.
Will you take me there?
And she looks down at her laundry like...
Mm-hmm. You can do that after.
Yes, ma'am.
Great, thank you.
And she will take her laundry with her.
Mm-hmm.
So she has this big basket.
Look how full her hands are.
There's...
She can't hold anything else in them. Great.
We're going to let this poor girl just haul all of this laundry.
Yep.
Yes.
How quickly the bride turns and is... No comment.
We could at least just let her put it down.
And she's a slender little thing, too. She's at least 2 feet shorter than you.
Mm-hmm. That's okay.
Let us help you with... Let me help you with some of your laundry.
Oh, no, no, absolutely not, madame. That would be so... That would be so improper.
Let her carry it.
I don't want to know what else is in her laundry.
And she will scurry out in front of you.
Mm-hmm. This is fine.
So scurry, scurry, scurry. And then she will lead you up the stairs. And then she will take a left, and then she will take a right.
That is not the directions you just gave me.
Do you say that?
Yes.
And she was like, I'm sorry, madame?
You said up the stairs. And then two lefts.
Uh-huh, and the door's right here. And if you look at the door, it looks like it matches the obsidian key. It's very rusty iron.
Mm-hmm.
It looks very heavy. And it's got rivets on it. Like it's a big, big guard door. And she's just like, but it's right here.
And none of these keys open doors that don't... Each of these keys is unique for the door.
Is that a trick? Yes, madame.
Make her stand here while we open the door.
You can go. Thank you. Thank you very much, Tula, for helping me out, and thank you. I will unlock...
But she will turn and just run.
Yeah, and I'll go ahead and put the key in the lock.
Okay.
Are we really such a fright? Maybe the head woman is very overbearing.
Well, I think she's been dealt with.
Was it really?
Yeah.
Oh. Never mind.
Perhaps she was overbearing.
Who knows what the servants have heard of. Anything happened to Mila last night, may not be in the best of moods.
Or what has happened to them, given what has already happened to us.
Not trying to hurt anyone. I just also want to make sure no one is going to hurt us, my sisters.
Why would anyone hurt us? We're taken care of here.
That's a great question. I'm sorry I asked, my sister. Let's go into this room and see what wonders our husband has for us here.
Excellent. So you put the key in the lock and you turn the key. You open the door, you go inside. The door closes behind you.
We need to work on these hinges.
Get some door stops.
We should have taken some laundry so that
yeah,
we could
shoved it in the door jam.
The room is dim.
Oh, there goes the door.
takes your eyes a moment or two to adjust down to the light in this room. It has no windows. Its walls are made of very thick bricks. And in the corner is a kiln and blacksmith tools. There are shelves with a number of oddities on them, but it's hard to see in this light. They glitter slightly. And then there's a row of pegs on the wall. Half of these pegs appear to have some sort of jewelry hanging from them. The other half has implements.
Implements?
The Virgin would like to... The Fatal would like to take stock of the tense situation.
Are you feeling tense?
The implements
make me feel tense.
The word implements makes me feel
the
tense.
The word implements. I mean, the previous two rooms we saw were rooms you would find in a house. Mm-hmm. This is less so. We did not have any previous knowledge of a vocational calling as a blacksmith. And so this is curious. The things in this room are overtly dangerous, mm-hmm. as opposed to...
Did we get saddled with another blacksmith?
Rich blacksmith, sister.
That's fair.
Why don't you take stock and then I can put in more details of the room. Those glittering things on the walls.
Go ahead, Fatah.
I would like to know what stalks the bride from the shadows.
You hear a skittering sound. A creak, creak, creak. And it doesn't sound like rats. You're used to rats. You grew up on a farm. You know what a barn rat sounds like. It sounds harder, pointier.
We should be on our guard. Whatever that sound is, I don't think it can be reasoned with.
We're not supposed to be in here, are we? You made us come in here.
We have been given permission by our husband to go everywhere but one place. Mm-hmm. And this is not that one place.
Mm-hmm. That's the smallest key, sister, don't you remember?
Yes.
You'll notice that the furnace in the corner is banked. It's not currently flaming hot, but there are coals in there. An iron or two are shoved down deep into the coals and stick out. The kiln is also inactive and very cold. Nothing happening there, but that skittering noise, it's almost like mandibles.
Would you like to investigate anything, Mother?
Seems to be coming from the shelves.
Oh, God. I would like to take stock of a tense situation.
Sure.
What? No, wait, we already asked that. What traps have been laid for the bride?
Oh, goodness. A small prick of the ego. That is the trap that has been laid here specifically for the bride. Well, by Bluebeard anyway.
Does he know about the blacksmith?
How could he?
No one did.
Mentioned it to him.
I would like to investigate a mysterious object.
There's many to choose from.
I would like to investigate the jewelry.
Sure.
So my initial thing that I wanted to do was to see if there were any cuffs. But that is not one of these two questions. So I would like to ask, what about this item is odd or uncanny? And what memories does this item hold?
Excellent. So you walk up to the brick wall with the nails driven into it, and from it are hanging several necklaces. And as you get close, and as your eyes kind of get on them in the dim light, you realize that you, you actually recognize these necklaces. Actually, all of them look exactly alike. They're twisted into a sort of beautiful knot.
Are they the same necklace that he gave our mother?
Yes. As for the memory that this item holds, when you get a really close look at the necklace, you realize that they are actually upcycled. And they are made from old nails. Twisted and turned into something beautiful, but pain lingers as a memory on these items.
This is a mistake. We're not supposed to be in here.
You know that your mother wears one of these around her very own neck. Well, did it's you think right, you were sister. Special?
He has.
You said he loves us.
Hands.
He loves us. What is this?
Practice. In order to make something of such beauty requires skill, and skill requires practice.
That is exactly right, Mother.
This is all your fault.
Sister!
The prince in your stories didn't stop becoming a prince when he fell in love. Why would Blackbeard stop becoming Blackbeard and stop making necklaces? If that's what he wants to do, if that's his hobby, it proves nor disproves love.
You are exactly right, sister.
Yes.
You're all against me.
No one is against you, sister.
No one is against us at all.
The necklaces sway and rattle like a breeze has washed over them. They creak.
There's no windows in here.
Breeze must be coming from the flue of the furnace.
Question, real quick,
yes.
For you. I know I can't. I know we're separated. Is there any way? Can I still interact with things, or would that? Because since we're all the same internet, so I can't interact with things. Okay, cool.
We can only bug them.
Back. We're back.
You can't just book it for skittering whatever's in the corner, my sister. Because
yeah. That sounded like hugs.
Flaming hugs.
No, we shan't dirty ourselves with violence.
No, no, we shan't. We shan't.
You smell something on this air.
In the air?
This breeze that is wafted through this room. It smells like flesh under the sun and dirt.
I don't like that I know what that smells like.
And sweat. And a familiar sort of metal smell. But surely it's just the rust, of course, from the nails.
I would like to investigate a mysterious object.
Yeah.
It seems, to the mother, it's only logical if there are no windows in this room. The only place a breeze can be coming from is the flue from the forge. Mm-hmm. So I would like to investigate the forge.
Excellent.
It's gonna be such a bad idea.
Please don't lean in.
No. What about this item is odd or uncanny?
So as the bride approaches the forge, she can feel the heat push at her face gently. Nothing strong. But it smells of coal and hot metal. And as you take the end of one of the pokers and you poke around, you turn some of the coals over, and the embers glow suddenly with the touch of oxygen upon them. But you do notice bits of something else that are not coals in the ashes.
Mm-hmm.
Are you shivering from fear?
I don't have the ring.
Okay, good.
You know I want to investigate the mysterious object. Oh, wait, Mother didn't ask second question.
Oh,
no,
okay.
Mother didn't ask the second question.
God.
They're all bad.
Yeah.
They are
ask
all
the
bad.
Ask the good one.
Why did Bluebeard keep this item?
So you poke deeper into the coals and turn them over, and you find bits of something else, and you pull it out with the bottom of the rake, and you see what appears to be some kind of bone.
I knew it!
What a surprise.
And you get the sense of a certain kind of satisfaction.
Size of bone?
Bones,
Yeah, size of
as
bones.
You turn them over. There.
I have some bone-related experience.
We have much bone related.
You do have some bone-related experience. Why don't you tell me what these bones look like?
Oh, God. So I'll tell you what I was hoping they weren't. Yeah. How's that sound?
That sounds great to me.
Like hand and finger bones.
What do those look like?
They are like, all right, so in here we just have a whole bunch of chunks of bones mm-hmm. that live in this area. And then finger bones are all like yay-ish. Do you know like what knuckle bones look like old sheep?
Small.
Yeah, so small, and there's just so many of them if it's an entire hand, for example. Mm-hmm. And the top ones are tiny and pointed.
Excellent. If you look very closely, you'll see that one of these bigger finger bones has a nail through it.
Stupendous. Well, this is.
How you doing, witch?
I'm making an executive decision to leave this room. I would like to exit.
Are you gonna try?
Yep.
Without getting a token?
Nope. I would like to propose that there are dead nailed hands in here. And that does not feel any sort of faithful to me.
Well, Bluebeard is a lord. He could have been punishing a severely deranged criminal.
Yeah, did you think about that?
In his third floor work room?
Privately and not in public, as he's entitled to do? No, I'm with you. This is not...
If you were punishing a criminal, you do it as an example.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Not secretly and away and with, what, a feeling of satisfaction?
You will hear a definitely mandibles clicking.
Was that real? Or did QQ do that?
The light.
We'll never know.
Gives the room a little bit extra glow.
Mm-hmm.
And as it catches what is refracting from those shelves, you see what the glass blowing was for. Rows and rows of scarab statues made of glass.
Mm-hmm.
And they are starting to wake up.
What? The statues are waking up?
How plausible is it?
Click, click, glitter.
That I can grab this finger bone with the nail in it.
Click.
And put it in my pocket and book it.
Glittering. You can grab it. And you can declare what the token is.
Yes, I want to grab
it.
You're
going to burn our hand.
So
I want to do it, but like the really fast. Like I want to take the rake, because mm-hmm. we've already established that I have that.
Yep.
And pull it to the edge mm-hmm. and take the corner of the dress and pick it up.
Your dress smokes.
Yep.
How are you interpreting this token?
It is definitely disloyalty. This is not what a good man does. A good man does not murder people in his workroom.
Well,
or at least burn them and nail them.
nails through their hands.
There's like, there would be like a plausible accident if somebody hits themselves in the hand with a hammer or whatever. They don't nail their finger.
They certainly don't nail their finger, leave it there and fall into it.
Yeah, and then burn their hand to hide that they did their accident.
There's no mistaking that this was done to someone.
Yes.
Who was it done to?
And then I am wanting to leave.
All right.
Yes, please.
So you are taking a token of disloyalty to get out of the room. You've described the truth and that something very barbaric has happened here. Mm-hmm. And the bride will take a token, and every one of you will take a trauma for revealing this truth.
Token, nail finger, sad face.
So which, because you've made this move, you have to give up the ring. You're gonna give it to the Fatale. Mm-hmm. Excellent. So
she's the only one who hasn't had it yet this round.
This round, yeah. You burst out of this room and you close the door behind you. The corner of your dress is smoking as you hold this little piece of bone and iron. And as you look down, you see a scarab has latched itself on to the corner of your dress. Just one, but it is trying to scale you now.
I would like to caress the horror.
Oh dear God. All right.
Oh, we're gonna have a pet.
Go for it.
They can probably smell fear. What, am I just gonna scream and throw it away? The only way to deal with this is to face the fear. Just like we need to face our marriage.
Jesus Christ. So what do you do?
So we have like a bone with a nail in it, right?
Yeah.
And we have a towel.
Do you have a towel?
We have a towel.
Do we have a towel?
We pulled a towel from the bathroom. I don't know if we carried it with us.
I think.
Okay. Are we wearing
petticoats? We put on the silk robe last time I checked. But I don't know.
Are we wearing petticoats?
You're wearing a pretty slinky dress.
Slinky dress. Nope. Okay. Well.
It's crawling.
I'm gonna take the bone nail thing and try to grasp the scarab and poke it with the nail.
You want to poke the scarab with a nail?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Is this
caressing the horror that you're trying to do?
Or is this dirtying yourself with violence?
Like, are you trying to be nice to it? Or are you trying to, like, defend yourself?
Oh, I see. These are sort of separate things.
Definitely separate things.
Okay, fine.
You want to dirty yourself with violence?
No. So, forget the nail. Forget the hand. If that's how this works, I will just pick the scarab up and try to look into its eyes, if it has any.
It's glittering glass eyes.
Glittering glass eyes.
I guess.
And I want to whisper to it, you're looking for someone else.
All right, let's see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead and roll. Is that snake eyes?
No, it's a six. And I get a plus one, so that's seven.
Because you're using which stat?
I'm using blood, and I have plus one on
blood. Perfect. So you barely make it.
Barely.
Okay, so you whisper to the scarab, and you say, what was it again?
You're looking for someone else.
You're looking for someone else.
And it will sort of flap its little scaraby wings and kind of shake its mandibles at you.
But we have to participate, don't we?
Yeah.
Oh, so it's not.
So who are you gonna sick it on?
Oh.
There was.
The Virgin has an idea, doesn't she?
That girl was innocent.
She was blonde.
There are many blonde women in this world.
We're in this mess because.
Didn't she try to send us in the wrong direction?
But she brought us to the right door. But she did try to steer in the wrong direction.
I cannot, sister!
Okay, so because you rolled a 7 to 9, you have to participate in this violence.
Send it to Mila. Mila is no longer an option.
I mean, I could try,
Mila's dead, yo. She dead.
Unless you have a better suggestion.
She was 9 years old. Did I miss that?
No, the chat's been. Chat's been. Because she was so short.
Gotcha.
I'm pretty sure no one 9 years old is going to survive long in this house.
Nah. Mm.
So it's ready to go get her, but it's a scarab. It needs you to go bring it to her.
Suppose it's back down the stairs.
Can't we just kill the bug?
I don't know much about extermination.
Its mandibles drip. A brown slime on your hands.
We progress down the stairs.
Are you just holding it out like this?
Yes.
So you're being led by this evil fucking scarab.
I'm so sorry.
As you reach the bottom, you don't recognize where you are.
Do I see people?
No. There's no carpets here.
I thought we went back the way we came.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we'll continue on.
The scarab will actually stick its wings out and start slowly flying. It will then go behind you and grab a piece of your hair. And it is now tugging you rather violently in a certain direction.
Okay.
All right. Follow it's where fine. The bug wants.
We have a friend.
How does your scalp feel?
Well, it's not
crawling.
Moist. It's hard to tell from all the sort of scabby blood from earlier.
Mm-hmm.
It's not great. It's a little tingly.
So the scarab will jerk you sometimes this way or that way. And it leads you down a hallway and down a left and then a right and then a left and two more rights. And then you are at the door of a washroom. Do you have a key?
Well, there's one key on the ring that looks particularly worn. It's rounded on all of its edges, with quite a few gouges in it, as if it's been dropped and picked up and dropped and picked up. And my guess is that this very homely key is probably the key to the laundry. So I take the key,
mm-hmm.
and I turn it in the lock.
Excellent. So you put the key in the lock and you turn it. You open the door and you go inside. The door closes behind you. And the scarab. And what you see is actually a vast room with large vats with steam rising out of them. Washclothes and linens. And there's the little girl, well, young woman, with blonde hair, with a big wooden paddle, worn from so much time spent in hot water, her calloused hands working and working very hard to turn what used to be sheets in a large tub. She's here alone.
And what is the scarab doing?
It's waiting patiently for you, Fatal. But it won't wait long.
I beckon for it.
It lands on your knuckles.
There is steaming water here.
If it were us or them, or her, should I just...
Is that the choice?
It gets agitated and it bites one of your knuckles. It won't wait long. Blood trickles down your wrist.
Think of our little brother.
That's the opposite of what we should be thinking about. That is the...
You hear scratching at the edge of the door from the outside. More skittering and mandibles.
Let it go. We're very sorry.
Do what you will.
I flick my hand towards the girl to release the beetle scarab.
So you...
And I whisper, Tula. silently, like just a murmur under a breeze.
Wow. So you unleash violence on this innocent young woman, who, as far as you know, has done nothing to you. And the scarab flies at her and attacks her. And it makes a horrible buzzing sound. It screeches. And she screams and she drops her paddle. She's flabbergasted. She doesn't know what's going on, but she sees you and she stops for a moment. And she looks into your eyes, beseeching you for help. Scared and alone. And then the scarab beetle sticks its mandible into her face. And it very efficiently rips out one of those eyes. And she falls to her knees and she screams bloody murder. She tries to put a hand over her face and she leans over the tub and blood spills into the water.
I'm just saying, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry.
The scarab seems satisfied with itself. And it flies back to you with the eyeball in its mandibles, and it drops it in your hand, where it then begins to eat the eye noisily.
Well.
And she's screaming.
She's still alive.
And she's screaming.
Yeah, losing an eye doesn't immediately kill you.
If it kills you at all.
Please! Please, God, help me. God, help me.
I want to care for her.
Excellent.
And do I have to give... I think I need to transfer the ring because I had caressed that horror.
Yep. So go ahead and transfer the ring. Your caress is done.
To mother?
To mother.
Mm-hmm. Do you want to take care of her?
Yes.
Yeah. Please, go ahead. I'm not great at this, but I'll do it.
Yes, I am going to care for the girl.
Mm-hmm. So how do you do that?
Lord.
Can we get rid of the scarab real quick? Can we just like shoo that out of the bottom of the door or something? Or are we just
gonna hold on to it? It's in the room with you.
Yeah.
It's not going anywhere.
Okay.
We are in a room full of laundry, I presume clean laundry somewhere. And we have tended many wounds in our lifetime. And we'll take some clean linens that we can rip strips from and try and use them to...
As you come near her, she stumbles away from you and screams, "No, God, please, no!
No, I'm sorry, no!
No, please!
Be still.
Don't touch me! You evil bitch!"
That's fair. That's completely fair. Yeah, that's fine.
It's justified. Just stand still and let me tend to your wound.
And she doesn't seem to be able to fight you. She's missing an eye and bleeding profusely. Yes.
So yes.
And it's easy to manhandle her, actually. Her wrists are very thin.
I'm going to continue get close to her, try and keep her in place.
And she cringes away.
While I bandage her face.
She sobs uncontrollably from her one good eye.
Put her out of her misery.
No!
Why? No, not into that either. No, thank you, Virgin.
Why? I'm sorry, girl. This place does... strange things to a person.
Just like
him. What did you say?
And then she will just freak out and just cry uncontrollably, hysterically.
What did he do to you?
And she's still crying. But as you care for her, she realizes she's not going to die. She's actually going to ignore your question. And she says, "Well, you know, you're stuck here with me and all of us. You're going to pay for this."
Girl, tell me what manner of man you know my husband to be.
You You owe me. You owe me so much. What will you give me? You cannot give me back my beauty or my face or my vision. What could you possibly give me?
The gift of death.
Do you actually say that?
No!
You're like a little mosquito.
Oh, gosh.
I have jewels that are worth likely a great deal more money than you will see in your life.
She spits on you.
Make her answer the question.
If we leave, can we take her with us?
Can we?
Can we try?
You can always try.
But there are all sorts
of... Promise her that.
Oh. If... When we leave this place, we will take you with us. I will take you with me.
Bursts into laughter. Leave? You're not leaving. Nobody leaves.
Of course, we are at some point leaving. People leave their homes all of the time. We can take you with us when we go to market, and then you can simply walk away if that's what you wish.
Lady of the house does not go to market.
This lady does.
No, she does not. Try the front door. Try it. You'll see. At this point, she's lost so much blood, and her adrenaline has run out, and she is going into shock.
She didn't let us touch her, right?
I mean, you did. You manhandled her.
I staunched her and I bandaged her.
Did you shove things in there to put pressure on the wound?
That would have been the idea.
Okay.
But I mean, if you're just gonna bleed out,
didn't hold it.
So she collapses to the floor.
Oh God.
That's fair.
That's fair.
That scarab is still here, and it sees its moment of opportunity. It will scurry over to her body and climb on
I am going to dirty myself with violence.
Excellent.
And try and stomp on the scarab.
While it's on her?
No.
Before it gets to her. Okay, so you're going to try to stomp on the glass scarab.
Yes.
All right.
Oh,
dirty yourself with violence.
Mom's the only one who can do it.
4, 5, 6, 7.
What happens on a 7 when you dirty yourself with violence?
On a 7 to 9, choose one from below as well. So on a hit, you inflict trauma as established and choose one, either disable, silence, or mutilate. I would like to disable.
Mm-hmm.
And on a 7 through 9, you choose one from below as well. Either your vulnerability gives them an opening to inflict trauma, or your carelessness leaves you in a bad spot.
I'm gonna pick 4.
Okay.
So, as this scarab comes up to this poor prone woman's body, you've had enough, and you try to stomp on it. And you succeed. You land your foot squarely on the scarab. But the scarab is made out of glass, remember?
Yes.
And as it shatters, the shards puncture your foot actually quite badly. And you, mother, actually, this is the whole bride. The whole bride takes another point of trauma. The scarab shatters into thousands of glittering little pieces. It's not a threat anymore. But so much more blood coming out of you. There's a shard of glass stuck into your foot. And as you reel from the pain, you realize that it is wiggling deeper into your flesh
of
its own accord.
We should pull this out and bandage ourselves.
I will sit down on the ground and yank that sucker out using some of the sheets.
Mm-hmm.
Or whatever that we've already been tearing up to grab it so I'm not cutting my fingers.
So you dig into the gristle of your own foot quite nauseating, actually, and the pain is very intense, and you see that it's actually gone through layers of your skin. You've never seen, actually, that your skin has layers before, but apparently it does. And as you try to use the sheet to grab it out, if you just can't find purchase, and it wiggles deeper, you better hurry.
Oh, the girl's sacrifice was for nothing.
I don't know what move to use, my sisters. Because I have a plan of a different thing, but this has to be taken care of first.
Cry out for help.
You could. You've got options, just not great ones.
You're all horrible.
So in case you're just joining us, this is Weekly Affirmations.
A positive feel-good show.
A positive feel-good show where we have all of the game feels. Hashtag game feels.
With a Z.
With a Z. Today we're playing Bluebeard's Bride. This is the third and final installment. This is the finale. This is a game that I co-designed with Sarah Richardson and Marissa Kelly. I'm Strix Beltran. And we're having a wonderful time being super creeped out.
All right, my sisters, what's the worst that could happen? This goes all the way through our foot, it travels up our leg, we can't walk as fast.
It can kill us.
You've got arteries.
Okay.
Is there a way to caress the horror and direct this pain to the girl? She's
You know, we already tried that, and I don't...
You asked for options?
That's true, I did. All right. I will cry out for help. Okay. I've done it again. I've done it before. I'll do it again. I'm the screamer, I guess.
This ring is really like
Oh, my sisters.
Oh.
What happened?
I rolled a 5.
Oh, goodness.
Which is not enough.
So, that means you failed a roll.
This is the Virgin. First roll we failed, I think.
How does this go? Terribly for her. And you have some prompts here that you can use. Once you are shattered, you have a sheet that you can work with. I want you to describe what happens to the bride now.
You fail.
Mm-hmm.
The glass shards of the scarab, a gift from our husband that we shattered, goes through our foot, one side to the other, bursts right out the top and right into our knee.
Oh, Jesus.
Like all the way up the leg part?
Nope.
Just like just projectile.
Oh,
got like it. A bullet.
Mm. Okay, I'm gonna stop you there because that's terrifying.
Mm. yeah, GG, bride. No re.
Gosh, you know, you failed that roll, and you really hurt yourself. How much trauma you all have?
3.
Yeah, one more.
Oh, God. You guys,
it's not that bad.
We only have 5 total.
So the next trauma any one of you takes, unless you heal yourselves, you will shatter.
So, my sisters.
So it's now sticking out of your knee. It might be a good time to grab it.
I have a plan.
Oh, and since you used,
I gave it over to the Fatal.
Gave it to the Fatal? Mm-hmm. Okay, perfect.
After we deal with this glass situation, I have a plan. I just wanted to let you know.
All right.
It's in your knee still. You're gonna do something.
Yeah. You're driving the bus, Fatal.
You can just grab it out of your knee and toss it. That's fine.
That's not wiggly no mo.
Nope.
Okay.
Braces herself against one of the giant wash tubs and wraps her hand in another sheet, pulls it out. It takes a minute. Are there any clean wash tubs? Can she just clean up a little bit?
Yeah.
Yeah, she'd like to do that.
There's a steaming tub over in the corner. Has something soaking in it.
Be careful. Often laundry is made with lye.
Yeah.
You go over to it, it's just socks.
Great. Are they long socks? I use them to tourniquet.
You can use a sock to tourniquet.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, sisters,
are you ready for my plan?
Am I?
You can get us through this. Is what I say. before I grab the glass.
What?
What are you doing?
We are done with that glass.
Sister, what are you doing?
Oh no.
And I do my cool move.
Sister, what are you doing?
I go for the back of the arm, left, my non-dominant hand, and I use the medium. Spill your blood to commune with the horrors of the room. Mark one trauma, and the groundskeeper will share silenced whisperings about what happened to the room and might ask you a question or two. Answer them. So.
Okay, so you are gonna shatter if you do that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I gave Mom my last words.
So tell me, describe to me what this all feels and what this looks like.
So I take the glass, and in the back of my arm, I make a series of markings. Mm-hmm. And it's from my years out in the woods, my personal experiences with nature and magic, and knowledge and revealing truth. Mm-hmm. And I say, what kind of man is my husband?
Okay, so you're at the edge here. You're at the breaking point. And as you break the piece of glass down your arm, your vision pierces the veil for a moment. In that moment of extremis. Extremis? Extremis. And why don't you ask your question one more time for me?
I say, what kind of man is my husband?
And the water in all of the washtubs in the room will bubble. Gently, but bubble. And as the bubbles pop, you hear this hissing noise. He's one of us. Perfect.
All right.
One of the below. And at that point, I believe you shatter, unless you want to ask one more question.
If you let me ask one more question, I will say, what did he do here?
Okay.
There we go.
What did he do here? Okay. So, all right, you asked for it. So, a vision will come to the bride's mind. All of you can see this. And it's like an overlay, ghostly film on top of the reality that you are in right now. And it's almost like a movie. And Bluebeard is here with a woman. She has reddish brown hair. And she's rather tall like you, but very slender. And they're sitting on the other edge of the tub. And they are kissing. Maybe kissing is the wrong word for it. What they're doing is very animalistic.
Are they making out?
They're a little more than making out.
Is it handsy?
It's a little handsy. And the woman will break away from Bluebeard's mouth and gasp. And she says, you know what I want. And he stops a moment and looks at her and raises an eyebrow. And he says, I'm not sure. She digs her fingers into his arm, the nails pointing, and says, you know what I want. And a dark look sets in his face. And he says, fine. He kisses her one more time violently, and then twists her around and grabs her by the hair. And pushes her face down into the tub. He waits. And then he pulls her head back out, gasping. And as she gasps for breath, he takes his mouth and puts it over hers and crushes his tongue into her throat. And then dizzy, he sticks her head down into the water again. And he holds her longer this time. And then he pulls her up and she's gasping and pleading and crying and smiling. And he kisses her again. And then, slowly, he pushes her head down one more time.
and he keeps it there. And the vision fades.
Was she struggling?
Yes. Yes, my dear, she was struggling.
Cool. So then I take one more point of trauma. Oh, did you have anything you wanted to ask me? You get the groundskeeper.
Mm-hmm. What do I get to ask you?
Might ask you a question or two, answer them.
How do you feel about this?
Like I got exactly what I needed.
Excellent. And then you shatter.
Mm-hmm.
So when you shatter, you and the Virgin, I think, have something to say.
Mm-hmm. The connection to my sisters has been severed. My place is no longer among those of you capable of rationality and thoughtful decisions. Our fragmented mind now feeds the horrors that plague the bride.
Welcome, so, sister.
I hoped it wouldn't come to this, but it's nice that I'm not alone.
What do you look like now, witch?
A mess. So I would say that her hair is wild the way that she liked it.
Chat takes a point of trauma.
Yeah. Also, I want to point out, because I saw this happen in chat, I actually have had this idea for a while, and I talked with everyone beforehand to make sure that they were all cool with self-harm. Like, not cool with self-harm, but that it wouldn't be too triggery. We are playing with the X card, and I know that we said that earlier. So if that triggered anyone in chat, I apologize. But we did pre-do that among us, and I wanted to encourage that people do that if they know that it's coming up. So we've had off-camera discussions.
Safety first.
Yes.
Always safety first.
So your hair's wild. Do you have, like, just carvings in your arms now that are bleeding?
Carvings that are, trigger warning, self-harm, carvings that are deep and like they have been done over and over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
And both arms, body, mm-hmm. and dressed in only like a nightgown.
Mm-hmm.
Wearing the necklace I made.
Yes.
There we go.
Okay. Whew. All right, so we're gonna take a moment to breathe. Cool. Excellent. So now we have two Shadow Sisters and two sisters who are still hanging on to sanity, but barely. So you're in this room. You wanna get out of it?
Do, but I'm not sure how much we know, metagaming for a second. If we, there is nothing about this room that teaches me that he is faithful. But if I take a token of disloyalty, we will die.
Can I metagame real quick, too?
We can.
I told Mom that she could save us.
Yes. No, I know.
I mean, you might have to do some mental magic here and just be like, nope. It means that he loves us. It means that he wants whatever the woman wants. Like, you're in a tough spot, and you got to decide how to go forward. But you can take that token of faithfulness.
Or we can escape without proposing a truce.
You can try to.
Try.
Not guaranteed. Could give hard you more trouble.
We would, the groundskeeper, Strix, would offer us a hard bargain or ugly choice to do so, and if we pay it, we escape.
Technically, we're safe here.
You call this safe.
Till you start
safer than we were. Safer than we were 10 minutes ago.
It will never be safe in this house. And we'll never be safe as long as we're in it.
What point is there in trying to keep going if this is what we're married to?
I mean, do you know what you saw? How do you interpret that?
She could have been fine.
Yeah. She was most certainly not fine. But she said that she wanted it?
Did we see her stop moving?
How do we know that that wasn't her only way out?
She said... Perhaps.
Oh, but he loves us, I'm
we,
sure.
We, sister, would not ask him such a thing. Perhaps that poor wretch wanted what was done.
Do you really know anything about what you saw? It could be interpreted so many ways.
We truly do not know anything about what we saw, aside from we have more cause for caution. But he did ask her if this was what she wanted. I would think you, of all people, would see the merit in that.
Yes. Yes. Does seem as if they discussed consent beforehand.
And we don't know the circumstances. Look what we have done to this girl. People might judge us had they not known our circumstances.
How long do you think you can keep this up, sisters?
What's the body count at now?
Oh, of people we've killed?
Yeah.
Now it's two.
Oh.
I will bend down to the scarab.
What's left of the
shards. What's less of the shards, and scoop up in some fabric a few of the shards.
Mm-hmm.
And wrap them sort of up. He was trying to protect us. He's trying to protect us. He sent the scarab as protection.
Yes. Yes. It listened when you spoke to it.
It was a friend.
Yes.
It was the only friend we had here.
You broke it.
I will keep it. Maybe we can put it back together. Maybe we can. I will take this shattered scarab as a token of faithfulness.
All my hard work.
Excellent. So you're going to take the scarab as a token of faithfulness. How many is that?
Two in each track.
Oh boy. And you will heal one trauma. And you will pass the ring to the only sister left who can take it. Where do you keep the shards on your person?
Between my breasts.
Oh, right, just...
Yeah. Right
by the heart.
Mm-hmm. Where they can easily wiggle closer. Wonderful. And then you... Step out of the room.
Yes.
And you leave Tula's prone body by the wash basins. Bravo. Such a survivor you are.
Who's saying that?
You don't know who's saying that.
Is that
so wait,
did
someone
that?
Really say that?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Or did they?
Oh! Okay, I'm gonna take stock of a tense situation.
So, ask your question.
God. What stalks the bride from the shadows?
Everything.
What stalks the bride from the shadows? Her own guilt.
That's the freaking truth.
How quickly you've turned into a monster. It didn't take really anything at all, did it?
We could have been out of here.
Exactly how could we have been out of here? I tried to make friends.
That
didn't go
well.
I
set it up for you.
Don't argue with her now. There is no point in arguing now.
We could have had our solace.
In now, of all times.
We could have tried again. I think you doomed us, sisters.
We...
Seems like you need some respite.
Yes, we do. We need, but we cannot go back to our room.
Well, you know there's a garden somewhere.
Perhaps we can find the greenhouse. I will look through the keys until I find one that looks as though it wasn't so much crafted as grown. It is a still green firm stem. Mm-hmm. The actual stem of the key is a firm green stem with a bit of texture to it in the way that old plants get, which would make the firmness and greenness a little odd. And the stem at the ring end of the key splinters off into many smaller, dry and yet still capable of holding their shape stems that rotate themselves around a small blue flower.
Mm. It's almost like a living key.
Yes. And the actual prong end of the key is thorns mm-hmm. that extend out from the end of the stalk.
It's like the teeth of the key?
Yes.
Are thorns?
Yes.
It's actually really cool. It's very attractive. Okay, so you set out to find this greenhouse, which goes with this living key with thorns for teeth. And as you travel the house, it's morning. Earlier in the morning, at least, than it was when you came in here.
Earlier?
Yeah, earlier.
I don't... Do you have any explanation for this? For the way time seems to be...
It's unnatural.
We haven't slept much. It just... The mind can't handle too many days. I'm sure we're just...
Yes.
Sleep is where we...
Yes. We did not eat much at dinner. We have been
when
through
much...
When
was the last time you
this
ate?
This evening.
Berries.
When we arrived... the berries. Yes. Maybe we still have some? The witch did grab a whole handful, mm-hmm. I eat some as we are traveling are we on the ground floor now?
I guess you can find your way there this time. Mm-hmm. You're on the ground floor, popping yeah. berries in your mouth, walking, looking for
where
the greenhouse is.
The greenhouse, or some kind of exit to a garden.
Mm-hmm. So, you actually find this quite easily. It's almost as if it's just sitting there right there for you. And you will see through the windows a cloister, meaning an inner courtyard. And across the inner courtyard, you do see what appears to be a greenhouse. As you step out into the early morning sunlight, it actually smells good and crisp and like fall and like nature and like normal.
I'm like outside.
Yes, feel a little better already.
You're always so wise. Mother,
I am trying, sister. All right.
The garden's then... beautiful if you take time to look at it.
I love it when you smile.
Do you see any of the roses?
No, you don't. There's butterflies and exotic plants and purples and greens and blues, and it smells lovely. And there's also a couch, a divan, in the corner, and a swing. And it all seems very lovely.
Should we...
Swing, like it's when we played as children. Remember that one time we set the vines up and...
Yes.
Played yes. with our little brother.
Yes.
All of our siblings, like... Swinging.
It would be such a good distraction.
Mm. I will go in and sit on the swing, very tentatively, making sure to test it for strength to hold me.
So you sit on the swing very gingerly, and it squeaks a little, the wood, as it adjusts under your weight. And then you get comfortable, and you start to sway back and forth. And it feels really nice. It just feels nice.
This is much better. Are there I'll look around to try and see if perhaps he grows blueberries out here anywhere that we might pick.
There's one or two bushes. It's late in the season, so they don't have much, but you can maybe pick a berry here or a berry there.
Yes, I will pick a few berries, eat them slowly. I don't want to make myself ill.
And I hope they're not poisoned.
Yeah.
No, they're just blueberries, silly thing.
Yeah. I know what a blueberry looks like.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. We've picked many.
The blueberries can sort of pause. The bride is so freaked out she can't even decide if blueberries are safe.
Listen. Excellent. Back before my shattering with the whole bowl of them, I was like, these have drugs in them.
All right.
I just feel it.
What is there to fear anymore after what we've seen? We can handle a few berries.
Yes, well, exactly.
How are we going to find a way to murder someone with berries now?
We are...
Wasn't it you, sister, that sent the painting after Mila?
Wasn't it you who listened to me when I told you to kill Tula?
So then you're behind all of it, isn't it?
I guess it's lucky that we're all together in this one.
Sisters, huh? We are all together. Regardless of our situation,
about half of us.
And when we get out of here, we will heal. We will.
Yeah. So,
when?
Why not get out of here?
When our husband comes home.
Oh, when he comes home to murder us if the house doesn't do it first. That's a super great plan. What was it? 6 weeks.
Oh. can I see?
We've made it what, a day?
As far as we know.
I'm going to stand up from the swing and start going back down, going down the lane of the garden looking for the greenhouse.
You want to leave this respite so soon? Okay.
It's not so much a respite when these voices keep whispering madness
so
in our ears.
So much arguing.
As you wish. So you hop off the swing and dust yourself off a little. And you wander over towards the greenhouse. And it's beautiful. It's dome-shaped. You thought it would be square, but it's not. And the glass is almost geometric in how it comes to a point. It's beautiful, really. And the morning sunlight is starting to be a strong noonlight, and it shines down, and you can feel the raw, loamy smell of earth and growing things. And you haven't even gone in yet.
We find the door, and I will put the key in the lock.
So, the lock of this door is rather strange. It is vines wrapped around a brass ring. And as you stick the key in the lock, the vines adjust ever so slightly.
Did that key move?
Perfectly normal.
Sister Witch?
Just like everything in this house. Yes, Sister Virgin.
You want to take bets who's going to join us next?
I mean, my plan was to have Mother Dearest.
Be quiet. We are going to make it through this.
There
has been some strangeness.
Am I right, sisters?
But we will...
Why would we get through it? What purpose is there in getting through this, if not to stop it?
Mm-hmm. Continue.
Stop what?
All the women. We've heard the stories, how many women that he supposedly has killed, and we have the bones, and the towel from the bath. These reminders of the man he is. We could stop him from marrying someone else like us.
What are you proposing, sister? How would we...
We need some more proof that he is who we think he is, and...
Who do we think he is?
I think he's a murderer.
Sister speaks the truth.
Doesn't the Virgin disagree with that? That he's a murderer, but...
I think we're the murderers.
Perhaps there will
They're
be something...
They're not mutually exclusive realities.
Perhaps there will be something less ambiguous here.
Something
That's
that will
why
prove.
I say yes. Let us look for more yes. evidence yes. Of yes. who he is.
Yes, I agree.
More.
Yes,
You're not
yes,
gonna find anything.
And I push open the door to the greenhouse and step inside.
Wonderful. So you put the key in the lock, and you turn the key. You open the door, you go inside, and the door closes behind you. And this time, the vines wrap so tightly around where you came from that you do not see the door any longer. You know it's there, maybe. And by the way, that whole time you were having that discussion, the bride was simply standing in front of the door with the key in the lock, still.
Paralyzed. Okay. I am...
So you have a look around, yes?
Yes, going to have a look around.
So, now that you're inside this greenhouse, it seems rather large. Much larger than you think it should.
Like it's bigger on the inside?
I don't know, is it?
It has many hobbies.
And it's divided into tiny sections. Tidy, tiny sections. There's flowering plants and there's bulbs. There's roses and hydrangeas and vines and thorns. And a pile in the corner of tools and shovels and other things. Dirt, gloves. And, well, the butterflies that you saw outside exist here in greater numbers, actually. They flutter against the top of the glass, battering their wings in a soft, soft, soft sound, and then drift back down again and then try. But they are not escaping.
Have you ever seen butterflies do that before?
No, sister.
What are they trying to get away from?
They are butterflies. They wish to fly free. That doesn't mean that they're escaping from anything. It only means that they are trapped against their nature.
There are so many flowers here. Surely there's something to keep them happy. At least some of them. Why won't any of them land on the flowers?
I am going to investigate some of the flowers.
Sure. So the bride walks over to the area that mostly holds flowers. And there's red ones, and there's blue ones, and they smell intoxicating, actually. What question is it that you want to ask?
Why did Bluebeard keep this item?
They bring him joy.
There's nothing wrong with such things.
He's a sensitive man.
Yes, we have seen his sensitivity.
You didn't see anything. You don't know what you saw, Mother.
We felt his sorrow in the bedroom.
We felt sorrow in the bedroom. Yes. How do you know it was his?
His wives were sick. You told me that yourself.
They could have
been sick. You're just assuming.
Sick with, what? Drowning?
Bathtubs? Oh, I can ask too. Why does he keep this item? Let's just go for the old standard. What about this item is odd or uncanny?
Oh, you would.
Yeah. Yeah,
so
we're gonna go it. We're
never,
gonna do
that's
it.
Never a good Strix reaction.
No, it's never,
oh,
never good.
Oh, and then look at the paper for a second.
Dear.
Ooh.
Never good.
What do I want to do to you?
You want to let us have cake?
Yeah, sure. Cake. So, as you lean over these flowers, you realize that there's actually things twined into their lower branches. So underneath the flowers a little, as you look closer, there's string. And the string has little objects wrapped around the stems and the roots, and it's almost like a fetish. The witch would recognize this if she was sane. So but a particular one catches your eye, and there's something poking up underneath the roots of this flower. Well, this plant. It looks like dark hair.
Mm. And it's attached to this string.
Well, it seems to be under the roots, wrapped with the roots.
I'm going to pull it out.
You recognize it because it's your doll. Covered in dirt and stained, ragged, and starting to decompose underneath the roots, wet. But it's you, all right.
He loves me, he loves me not.
We gave him that as a gift.
And our father made it.
As a wedding gift.
Look how he respects it.
You must be a mistake. It must be one of the jealous housekeepers.
Why would he leave it?
Why would he bury it?
Perhaps it was taken. Perhaps he did bury it.
It was Miller.
Perhaps it was sympathetic magic.
It's good that
because
he
wants us to die.
You do notice a bit of fabric tied up in the string.
Kind of fabric. Do we have to investigate that separately?
You might want to.
I would like to investigate the mysterious fabric tied onto the doll that was once ours.
Mm-hmm.
And it's still reeking of mildew. Why did Bluebeard keep this item, the fabric?
Control.
What about this fabric? Which one of these do I want? Which questions do I want to ask? What memories does this fabric hold?
Triumph.
Pardon?
Memories of triumph. Of slow nurturing. And blooming. And triumph. This is a greenhouse, after all. That's what happens here. Things bloom.
What's underneath the other flowers?
Well, if you look closely, each one of the plants is a different colored flower, and they're all tied with bits of things. Hair, a brooch, fabric, a nail, the finger kind, not the iron kind.
All of these things buried underneath the flowers.
I assume one under each flower?
Well, a conglomeration of things under each flower.
So this is his form of gardening. All of his wives.
Do
flowers,
we find anything with blonde hair?
If you're looking for it.
I'm looking for it.
So you begin pawing almost frantically through these flowers, looking for one with blonde hair. And you actually have to wade into the area where these flowers are, because there's just so many of them. But finally, towards the back, your hands stained with dirt, your knees wet, you find a white lily. And, yes, there's a bit of blonde hair tied to one of its stems.
Is there something buried in the dirt under it?
Well, you'd have to dig to
I'm
find out.
I'm going to dig to find out. I grab, for a moment, startled at having found what I was frantically looking for, and then, with shaking hands,
I want you to shiver from fear.
God. Okay. So just so folks know, when you shiver from fear, name the thing you're most afraid will happen, and the GM will tell you how it's worse than you feared. Keep the ring and choose two of the below options, or pass the ring and choose one.
So first describe what you're actually afraid is going to happen now.
I am afraid that I am going to find something, some memento of this. I'm afraid I'm going to find another bone from the previous wife.
Mm-hmm. So you're afraid to find remains of this woman?
Yes, I'm afraid to find something that I cannot justify away as being some kind of eccentric habit when I know that the blonde hair on the towels, on the dresses, I know they did not belong to that servant girl. I know they belonged to one of his wives.
Okay. So, are you gonna pick two or are you gonna pick one?
The bride looks a fright right now. She's covered in dirt. She looks like...
in blood.
I am going to pass the ring. And I am going to... it speaks to me and I take one trauma.
Oh, God. Okay. Okay. So you think you're gonna find bones of the previous wife, but it's worse than that. As you dig into the dirt, you claw deeper and deeper, and then your fingers grasp around something. And you yank it up, and a gold chain dangles from your fingers. And as you open your palm, you find a very heavy, weighty gold locket. And with a trembling hand, you open the locket.
And I look inside.
And you do look inside.
Yes.
What you see is on one panel a young man, handsome, actually, but with just the beginnings of stubble. And it's a miniature painting, not a photo. Someone took extreme care with this. And then the other panel of the locket is a beautiful young woman who smiles with such joy radiating out of her face you can barely stand to look at it. And if you turn it, on the back, it says very simply one tiny little word. Always. Always.
I think that was his first wife, sisters? I wonder if she was the first one he murdered.
Can he really be faithful to us?
We're not supposed to be here!
Why would a person bury such things? Why would he?
He has his reasons. We're not supposed to be here. We should go.
A servant did not do.
We should go.
Always.
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 Such devotion. Such love.
And now she's dead?
Can I investigate this object?
Sure.
I would like to know what memories, or why did Bluebeard keep this item?
Why did Bluebeard keep this item? Oh, that's very simple. He likes trophies.
Not out of love, not out of remembrance.
So hot under these cuffs, sister.
I don't.
The butterflies in this hothouse will begin descending upon you, gently, floating ever so slightly, and landing on your shoulder, on your head, on your back. They alight on you, as if you yourself have been enlightened somehow.
Sister. I think he means us harm.
Yes.
It took butterflies to do it, sisters, but I think you figured it out.
We need proof.
if anyone will believe us.
I agree with Mother.
We have to know what's in that room.
He said not to go in that room.
We're
not going in that room!
Sister! All of the horrors that we have seen, and there is one place he thinks too much? Something he doesn't think this would drive us away to madness, to who knows what, but in that room is something that will?
And what right does he have to demand anything of us? This marriage is not consummated. He left before we ever had a chance to join as human.
The townspeople will want proof.
Look at the tokens, sisters. We've been collecting them for a reason.
About consummation.
No, I agree with you. I'm trying to explain to the virgin that it doesn't matter that he told us not to visit that room.
What? Yes. What will the townspeople do when they find out we murdered some innocent girls? We know better
dead.
Than him if this is the case.
They will
we're
not
meant to
know.
Be together. They will know.
These butterflies seem perturbed now, and they start flying at you a little more violently. One or two smacks you in the face as you stand there having this internal conversation frozen in place.
Okay. Oh, shit.
They're tiny proboscises flick at you. It doesn't hurt, but you can feel it on your skin.
Why are you sorry? You haven't done anything.
No, look at me.
Thank you, Mother.
Mother,
you are going
time.
To make it out of here. You... I have seen too much. I cannot, but you can. You are strong.
No, I have not seen enough to be
you
this strong.
You are strong, and I will make you stronger. Do you understand? You will get us out of here. You will fix this. You will protect us. I believe in you.
Why does it have to be you?
Because there is no other way.
Aww. I am going to use Martyr.
Mm-hmm.
And offer forgiveness for a sister's past sins because you did what you had to protect us. Thank you, Mother.
And take two trauma in order to heal one for the fatale. And with that shatter.
So the mother, with kindness and grace in her eyes, looks lovingly at the fatale and shatters. And I believe you all have something to do together.
The connection to my sisters has been severed. My place is no longer among those of you capable of rational and thoughtful decisions. Our fragmented mind now feeds the horrors that plague the bride.
Welcome, Mother.
Welcome, Mother.
I want to take the locket as a token of disloyalty and leave the room.
Easy enough. I think that explains itself. Take a trauma. Just one. By yourself. Alone in the darkness of your soul, you leave the greenhouse and you look around at the bright sky around you, and it is brittle and meaningless. And as you mark that last token of disloyalty, you will attempt to do something, anything, besides stay here.
And
you've triggered an ending?
We've three tokens of disloyalty.
So three tokens of disloyalty triggers an ending. Why don't you grab that final room? So under tokens of disloyalty, what does it say?
When you free Bluebeard's house as a disloyal bride, tell the groundskeeper if you will present your tokens to the town to try and prevent Bluebeard from killing anyone ever again, or run away and try to start anew. The groundskeeper will tell you what happens.
What do you choose?
The chance at freedom or the chance at retribution? To start again or to make sure this happens to nobody else ever again?
Mother told me that I would survive, but she also said that I would fix things. Fix things. And the little girl in the laundry, We have to stop it. We have to stop it. I present my tokens to the town. The bone with the nail in it and the locket. The towel.
The glass. So you flee to the town on foot, limping with your injured leg. A mess covered in dirt. Deranged. Barely hanging on to sanity. And as you stumble into the town square, you begin yelling. Look! What do you say?
Bluebeard's wives did not leave willingly. His servants live in fear. Someone has to stop this. His wives had no say in their demise.
The townspeople gather around you, but give you some distance, as if you yourself might be catching or rabid.
There are wrong things. I have seen things there. You must go for yourself and see them yourself. Here, I have the keys. Go see for yourself.
And now I'm going to ask you some questions, Bride. Virgin, what did the town do to the Bride to rid themselves of her disloyal ravings?
They locked her up in the middle of town, covered her mouth, and let her sit there.
For how long?
As long as it took.
Which, how did Bluebeard blackmail your family into silence?
He took our little brother
to his mansion
and promised that if word were to get out, that he would suffer.
Mother, what reason does the Bride give for Bluebeard not divorcing her?
Give it to the townspeople?
How does she avoid losing face?
She finally concocts a story that she had been drugged and tricked by vicious servants who had taken the opportunity of her husband's absence to try and rid themselves of the new lady of the house, and that she, being young and foolish, had fallen for their tricks.
Is the Bride sorry?
Very sorry.
How sorry?
So incredibly sorry for the trouble that she has caused.
Not sorry.
We are not sorry. But we say we are sorry.
Oh, Fatale, how does the Bride spend her days now?
Is she out of the jail in the center of town? Or is she still there?
She's still there.
She writes the name Camilla over and over again in the dirt of the cell. She writes the name Camilla everywhere she can find. She draws from memory the picture from the portrait in the haunted portrait. She draws scarabs.
Do any of her portraits have eyes?
Some only have one.
There is no hope.
One more question. And maybe the bride can answer this together, or at least what's left of her. What loving gift does Bluebeard send the bride for their wedding anniversary?
Are you asking just the remaining?
I'm asking all of you.
I think he sent us a new doll.
A new doll?
One with handmade, small brass cuffs.
And one eye.
And stained with blood that is not ours.
That says always.
And a rose in her hair. It's a very ornate doll.
It's a lot of, there's a lot
it's
of
stuff. It's a very meticulous
doll.
It is very meticulous.
He spent everything in his house.
A lot of time on it. It's perfect.
It's nicer than anything she's ever had.
Where do we keep it, sisters? Or does it disappear?
Well, she goes to place it in her corset and finds the shards of glass. Places them next to the doll.
And that, as you consider those shards, is the end of the game.
Weekly affirmations, feel good show. The most positive thing on this channel where we kill 90-year-olds. Hello, Bluebeard's motherfucking bride.
The cast needs a minute to decompress. So here's what we're gonna do now. We're gonna do some decompression. We're gonna talk a little bit. We're gonna unravel this. And then we'll do some affirmations at the end of the show, but we really actually do need to take the time to unpack this a little bit. So, just take a second. Just take a second. Stretch.
I'm gonna drink my empty cup of water.
Drink your empty cup of water. Chat, let us know how you're doing.
And yes, that is open flame.
Not electric.
Yeah, QQ, I'm standing. Yeah, what are you gonna do? I'm standing. You said I couldn't stand. I am standing. Thank you, I appreciate it. I love you. You're the best. You're the best. Your purple hair's amazing.
Shake it out. Okay.
We need a new subscriber.
Yeah. Please, someone subscribe so we can dance. Why are you looking at the tiniest glasses? Because everyone was standing there.
Wow. So, thank you. I think everyone did a fantastic fucking job.
Yay!
Wow. That was amazing. I had a really great time. I want to check in with everybody. How we doing? How is there, like, what are you feeling right now?
Am I gonna need a drink?
Okay.
I almost drank that one. I'm like super happy that I did this with all of you.
Yes, it was like, oh my god.
This is my first time ever being recorded playing any game ever. I've played tabletop for a long time. This is my first time doing a non-D&D game and my first time being recorded. So
that's been so awesome.
A really amazing experience that I felt incredibly safe in, which I did not think was gonna happen. when we talked about it initially, I'm like, I'm gonna have so many walls up, it's gonna be amazing. Uh-huh. And then today I was just like, fuck walls.
That's awesome. So one thing I'd like us to do now is not call each other by our character names, but just use our regular names from now on. Just help us get some distance from the characters. So one thing that I like to do, and you can participate or not, is just say like one thing that you liked about what someone else did today. I want to compliment Cheryl. The emotion that you brought to those final moments with the mother, who also did a fantastic job, was really great. Like, I was feeling what you were feeling. It was clear to me like you were actually feeling it.
And I thought that was very brave and vulnerable and awesome. And I'm gonna hug you now.
Hey, you almost made me cry.
I thought I was gonna cry just watching you.
Yes.
It was amazing.
Thank you. 100%.
So that was fantastic. Good job. You guys can give compliments too.
Can I?
You don't mind.
Can I? Like, I well, first off, this is like probably the most serious one that I've got to play. Mm-hmm. I don't come from a huge RPG background, mm-hmm. but like that, this, I want to just compliment the writing of this game and the way this whole thing goes. Like, this was fantastic, and oh god, I just can't. I was so excited when you mentioned this, that when you said that this was gonna be played on, I was like, please, look, notice me. But this is fantastic. I'm gonna buy the hell out of this game. Yeah. I'm gonna buy the fucking hell out of this game.
thank you. It is on Kickstarter right now.
Yeah, check it out. It needs more money.
Oh my goodness.
I want to say more than one positive thing.
You can say as many as you like.
Marcus, you did such an excellent job inhabiting a character that had already been rolled, but like you were just present. You were so present the whole time, and it is so hard when the character doesn't have as much agency as you've got put in that situation, and you really influenced the way the game rolls.
Yeah.
So that was,
well,
that was,
thank you so much. Awesome.
You hopped right in, that was great.
Thank yes. you. And thank you for being here.
And thank you for just, you know, bringing so much to Mother in those last couple of moments and letting the journey kind of happen, because both of us, I think, kind of changed the way our characters felt about each other in that last little bit.
Yes, that last bit was very good. Yes. I don't even know how to words right now.
And thank you all for supporting me with the, I felt uncomfortable with the choices my character was making, but I felt safe in making them in the scope of the story, so thank you for letting that happen.
Yeah. Super cool magic time.
Yeah. I thought all of you guys were just fantastic. Like, this was so good. And Ajit too. Ajit, if you're watching.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Oh. Oh my god, yeah.
Thank you so much.
Can we just do that real quick?
Yes.
Because I wanted to say that earlier, but I also didn't want to interrupt because I know we're just getting started. We have to finish this out. But like, he set up this fantastic thing. I was watching it all today, just kind of get the gist of it. And like, he set this up so well, and I was just trying to build on what he did, and he was fantastic. So thank you again for having me be here.
Yeah.
And thank you for doing that, Ajit. You were fantastic. Mwah.
And thank you, chat, for supporting us too.
Yeah.
We actually can't do this if this space is not safe. So, good job.
Aw, I see that. So I try, like, I'm normally a very, like, open and just, like, here's everything I'm feeling all the time type of person. Mm-hmm. And I try to scale that back very. very much, because that can be a little intense for people, but I felt that was a really good a time to break character and talk about it as a survivor of whatever traumas that I'm not going to get into. I wanted to make sure that people who are watching knew that that wasn't a thoughtless thing, and you know, we did have our warning at the very beginning, but it wasn't in the description, I don't think, so.
Money. Amazing. Excellently written. Excellent cast. Excellent DMing. 10/10.
Oh,
that was indeed 10/10.
Thank you.
Oh, so, but my good thing.
Yeah.
I am just so happy with. Oh, with.
You did it,
didn't
I? I did.
Okay. Thank you. I really loved Strix. How you didn't. I talked about this a little bit, like on the first one, but you did not ease us into anything. It was scary and uncomfortable the entire time, which I've also never experienced with horror. Mm-hmm. Like, normally you watch a horror movie in the first 45 minutes of the movie.
Money. Great twists and turns did dwell inside. Such feels, fears, and agendas to hide. What great fun, job well done. Thanks for playing Bluebeard's Bride. Hashtag Thumper Pride.
Oh, Prosperous Guard, awesome. Again, killing it!
Oh,
killing it!
That was great.
But you know, the first like 45 minutes of a horror movie are pointless because it's all going to be, you know, fake scares. But this was just spot on the whole time. And really, like,
I already kickstarted, and I'm gonna bring this to my game group, and I'm going to destroy them all.
I cannot wait to see to be like on a, in a position where I can play as a non-shattered character, mm-hmm. because like I want to. Because I mean, granted, it was creepy, but there was also a part of me that was on the creepier side. Mm-hmm. I was, as you said in the last thing, this character was gonna be on your side, closer mm-hmm. than their side. But like, this was intense the entire time. Like, yeah. It was every fucking turn. No, thank you. It was awesome. in a very thank you way. Go support the Kickstarter. Not putting it down.
So also, not you know, not to embarrass you with just heaps and heaps of trash.
Subscribe high.
Yeah, get those sandwiches out.
Subs. Ah, oh, that's super awesome.
We need to jump around.
Okay. Oh, I did it again. Who was that?
Last sub, our latest thumper and new.
Bam fails. Got it,
Bam fails. All right.
And no. I also love that you guys knew what I wanted to do, and you like just really didn't do it immediately. And I had to sit. and just be like, maybe we'll die. Like, I planned this and no one's doing it. And maybe we'll die.
No, I totally knew what you wanted. Yeah. And I was just like, okay. No, that, it was gonna happen.
That loss of agency.
But I love that you think there's a change in the witch. Like, she became more open about things once she passed over the shadow.
Everybody did some really good like evolution through.
Yeah.
That actually kind of Demolition has a good question. Mm. If you'd play this game again as a different persona, which would you choose?
Oh, I want to try the animus.
Yeah,
that sounds really fun.
I'm ready to dirty myself with violence. That's my favorite
dirty
move.
Just the best wording you could possibly have.
Oh, no, you're good.
You were going to say something?
Yes, I was going to say something. Also, thank you, Ephithrio. I was going to say that I really enjoyed that you as a GM, like, because this kind of thing, I think, if you're not like respectful of the material and of the group that you're with, you can go like way too freaking far mm-hmm. with this. Mm-hmm. And I really enjoyed that you just seemed to intuit like how like you were there with us as we pushed it. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, when you were the one driving the horror, rather than stepping along as we pushed you, being so freaking creepy without ever going too far. Like, that takes a skill, you guys.
Holy crap, that was so good. Spending the last of my fun money for the month on affirmations for the cast because they're going to need one. I spent the rest backing this excellent thing.
Thank you, Krellen.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, and it's so clever how you, like, you kind of force us to describe things, which sort of guarantees they're gonna start out in our comfort zones.
Uh-huh. So
it's not just like a pile of creepy things, it's creepy things you pull out and yes ands.
Mm-hmm.
You take them and
twist them. And that's great. And it seems to be a part of, like, the mechanics of gameplay to be like, you describe that. And then we'll see what happens.
That's why I don't shiver from fear. Because I don't like jump scares and woo woogly things that you are scary. It's more scary when it's stuff you are scared of. Mm-hmm. And I let you guys tell me how scared you want to be. So that's super awesome.
Who else did you want to be? Who would you play next time?
So when I was looking over the sheets before we started this at all, my two that I was looking at were either the mother or the animus. I would also really like to try the animus, but honestly, like, any.
Mm-hmm. You can play the same one with a different move, and it would be a
different character.
A different kind of mother, because there are so many kinds of mothers.
Oh yeah.
Yes, there are.
You did find a way, as the mother, you did find several ways to, like, while still being that, like, kind of, like, have that kind of sweet, like, everything could be fine. You did have that kind of, like, semi-creepy abusive mother thing in there too. I noticed that a lot in the first the first time when you were kind of doing the world building and stuff. Like, that was really cool. I wasn't there for that episode, but good job. That was good. I like that a lot.
That's good.
I like that a lot.
Okay, now I want to talk about parts that were hard. So I'm going to start with the hard part for me. And one of the hard parts for me actually was the ending with Cheryl. When you took out the glass, I was like, oh no.
Yeah, that's why I just set it down.
I was like, okay, I need to time this right because I'm either going to have to X card her or I'm going to have to just put the ending in there. And I'd rather put the ending in there than X card. Mm-hmm. I like using the X card. But I was like, if she tries to commit suicide, like there's no way that I'm gonna let this happen. Because I wasn't comfortable with it. So I was like mentally hovering, like, what is she gonna do? This is really uncomfortable. Is she gonna like try to slit her wrists with the shards of glass? Because I'm gonna have to stop that, because I don't want that as the GM. And I was like, is she gonna do it? And then like, I think you read me and you gave me the opportunity to go and scene so that we left it ambiguous, which I was really happy with. But it was a moment as a GM where I was like, ah, this could go sideways. I better take care of this. Like. Mm-hmm. Ready to use the X card. So that was a moment that was difficult for me. It was rewarding because we got it right, but I was like, ooh, man, like I could have got that really wrong.
So can I ask you a question just specifically about, hello, thank you for following. Like specifically as a storyteller, as a writer, like if that was what she was going for and if we were in a situation where we were all very, like not like, I mean, like yay, but like very comfortable, like that was a comfortable thing. Would you also think about like stopping, like right, like having a piece of the story. Again, I don't know a whole lot about this stuff, but like having a piece of the story, which is like she might go to it, but you as the GM can actually stop it. Like the thing will not go to her, so she's stuck suffering.
The reason why I would X card it is because I personally felt uncomfortable with it. Okay. That's what the X card is for. So if one person at the table is not cool with it, it's X carded. And for me this time, it was me that was uncomfortable. But also if I was like looking over at you or Mel and you're like, no, like in a bad way, like this is not fun, I'm upset, then I'd be like, X card for that too.
Okay.
And anyone can do that for anyone in the table. But really it's just like, is it fun? No, this is not fun, then we're done with it.
Yeah.
And it was just on that line where I was like, is this fun or is it, oh my God, which is perfect. but if it had veered over to that line, I would just been like, nope, I don't like that.
And that's why the X card is fantastic and
it's
important
great.
And it was invented by John Stamos. What was his name again?
John Stravoloff.
John Stravoloff. He's a nice guy. He was in a couple weeks, or a couple months ago, or like a month ago or something.
Yeah, he was.
Fantastic. Awesome guy.
He was here for my engagement party. Woo! So, so that was a hard moment for me. If you feel like sharing a hard moment, you can, but this is one where you don't have to share anything at all if you don't want to.
It was really hard for me in the moment where I had the scarab and like facing the girl. The other times were like when we sicked it on Mila, we weren't near her. Mm-hmm. And that there was that whole like, separating myself from the character, like the character's doing this, it's not you, we're in roleplay, it's you're trying to survive, but I had very nearly, you know, just turned the scarab on us. Mm-hmm. Very difficult to wrestle with that.
Yeah. That was a very interesting dynamic that was unique to you guys, where you're like, nope, I'm gonna survive, and you attacked people almost viciously, kind of like without blinking an eye. And obviously there were internal struggles, but it was really interesting to see when the bride is faced with a monstrous for her survival, how quickly she becomes monstrous. Mm-hmm. I thought that was a really neat dynamic.
Mm-hmm. I will very quickly turn off the emotional part of myself when playing any sort of things to make those choices. And I find that I go into like this mechanical thing where I'm just like, sucks. And I think that if I played more of these types of games, that I might start having a different reaction. Yeah. So it was cool to see other people have it. Mm-hmm. I've always played in games with a lot of people that I didn't feel comfortable exploring things with. Yeah. And I feel like this group of people I would have if we ever play games again.
Yeah. So Goatee Bear asked a good question about the X card and basically how it works when we tap it. So the X card is basically a retcon. It's a silent retcon. So you just go, nope, not that thing. You don't have to say why. You don't stop to explain anything. Everyone else at the table knows that that's the signal that we're just going to make something else up now. So if it was a giant spider, maybe now it's a ghost. Or if you don't want the ghost, maybe it's blood. Or it's something else. So that way it's just like, okay, not that thing. And then we move on. So that's how the X card works in principle. Maybe I should have just tipped it for fun. But I like the moment that we rode there.
I've been thinking,
I've been thinking that in my
games, I'm gonna have to like tell one of my friends in advance, like you need to X card something in the first session.
Yes, yeah. It's always good to X card early so that everyone gets used to it.
I would say the hard part for me, and I don't remember if we discussed this with the cameras going or the cameras not, so forgive me if folks have heard this already, was the bathtub thing.
Yeah.
Because that is definitely one of those things, like there is a certain level of assault that I am not okay with in my fiction and or my role play either. And that was one of those moments for me, like with you, with the near, maybe she's gonna commit suicide, where my hand was just kind
we
of like
we didn't want the friend of the octopus.
Am I there? Am I not there?
Like,
and the hesitation, just to be totally totally clear with everyone, the hesitation was not in whether or not I felt comfortable using the X card. It was whether or not that moment had yet been reached for me, because. The X card only works when you are with a group of people who have already decided, as we have already decided, that you're going to respect each other enough to, when you X card, it's just respected and it's done and it's not an issue. So yeah, just to be totally clear, that was my hesitation.
It's totally
that was that why that was a tough moment for me, because I was like, okay, how far are we going. So,
well, and I think that you are a very good read of character because you were like, these things are happening, and we were like, we are leaving the tub. We are going now. Farewell. And then it's like they keep happening, and we're like, more leaving the tub. Like, you didn't do any sort of like restraining or anything like that. You were very good at reading the cues and being like, y'all need to act, but I'm not going to creep you out and force you now to do this because you didn't act fast enough.
Yeah.
And chat, you are right, you saw smoke. We have almost burned through our tea lights and they're extinguishing themselves dramatically.
I've been seeing them.
One by one.
No, it was actually happening like when you cracked, one of them just went.
And
I
was really?
Like, I didn't want to stop.
Oh, you know, I think I saw.
That's like, why I play the witch.
I'm pretty sure one of them like just cracked. Like, or something was happening, some smoke was happening.
That's funny. Fine.
So maybe the most important question here is, did you have fun?
Yes.
I had so I'm poor, and I had enough fun that I went and was like, I have to go put $200 in this Kickstarter. And I'm gonna be like, okay, friends group, if you want me to run games, like,
let's share.
At least cook for me.
I am grateful that in the Kickstarter you guys have included resources for people who, like me, are a little hard. I find it occasionally difficult to. I find it occasionally difficult to make things up on the fly, so I like that there are
there's
resources
gonna be, like,
available.
Cards rooms and objects and all sorts of. Because I mean,
I have just like text of resources that I could have used. I just don't need them very much, but we know that other GMs absolutely do, and so we've provided like all kinds of stuff. So just really quickly here, this is a sheet called Room Threats that GMs get as part of the game. And it's, if you don't know feminine horror very well, or you're just like, what do I do? We kind of spell it out for you. So we say there's like different kinds of horror, right? So there's body horror, there's horror on motherhood, religion, sexuality. Yeah, look at that follow. Yay. So it could be like, so for bodily, some of the suggestions are drug her, perform a medical procedure, shame the bride by introducing her to a perfect woman, paper the room with imagery of what society demands, showcase a flaw for all to see. Exhibit what happens to a woman who refuses to conform. So these are all really specific gendered horror things.
Like, yay!
Oh!
Oh,
yes!
Yes!
I gotta write it down. Okay.
Oh yeah!
Awesome! Thank you, Miss Twyla, for subbing. Mwah. You're super cool. You're gonna get an affirmation for that. Just stick around a couple more minutes. We're gonna get to those.
Yeah, when you just said medical procedure, like I felt my heart just go.
Yeah, that was.
Yeah,
I didn't watch Hostel or Saw for
a little
real good reason.
We also have things like trigger a ritual hunt or initiation. Possess an object in the room, like a goblet, bed, or a dress. Surface what is buried underfoot. Tempt the bride with simple acts, orgies, theft, or murder.
Yeah.
So all
Did
you really have to do is
that.
Like, you just be like, this one. All of them are gonna be terrifying.
Yeah.
So, there's definitely the resources there. A little more juice.
Looney Tunes, yes, these camera shots are legit. Oh,
yeah. Yeah. Good job, Chiquio.
On the board.
I'm glad someone noticed my LaCroix.
Yes.
Instead vaporwave.
Oh. Yeah. That was beautiful.
It was so great.
That was beautiful.
It's LaCroix, sweetie?
No, it's not sweet tea, it's seltzer.
No, sweetie.
I don't know.
You don't get any props for the talking rain, yeah. though? I mean, come on, talking rain's where it's at.
It's very Seattle.
It's totally true. Water.
Yeah, it's all kinds of seltzer. But to answer your question, like, I appreciate that it's, I had fun because it's a different type of storytelling. Mm-hmm. Like, I wasn't, you know, it's hard to use the word fun when you're like, should I murder that girl? But like, that's not where the fun necessarily is. But like the escapism and the putting people enough down that they can tell a story they've never told before. Mm-hmm. That's very cool.
Yeah, the most scary stuff I've ever gotten is like, and there's a dead body and a monster
and a dog too. Yeah, it's like the oogly booglies, right?
Yeah, and they're like, it's a mind flayer. And I'm like, I know those stats. And like, it does nothing for me, but that's all I've gotten. This is so cool.
Oh my gosh. Oh man.
Vaporwave.
There we go. Vaporwave. There we go. Nice. I actually legit love vaporwave as a music genre.
Have you
heard The Simpsons vaporwave?
What the F is vaporwave?
You don't know what vaporwave? I'm gonna introduce you.
Yeah, oh my gosh, you guys. Strix has so much she needs to introduce me to. Snail cream and vaporwave.
It's a sleepover.
Do you snail cream?
Oh yeah.
I'm all up on that Mimi box.
I love Asian beauty.
Yeah,
I love it.
Oh man.
It's Korean skincare. It'll change your life.
Starfish, snails.
Yeah, sea anemones, just slap them on your face.
Oh, yeah. This is gonna be the rest of the show, guys. This is it. That's all it is.
Anyway, so any last thoughts or anything that the game brought up for you that you thought was interesting or that you guys wanted to talk about before we transition over to doing our last few affirmations for the day?
Actually, I was thinking about this because I know that you've explained the X-Craigs have been on your show mm-hmm. like forever. I've been on the show a lot.
Uh-huh.
So I've explained, this is the first game where I actually was like, where I didn't feel like it because I don't really have anything, which is a thing that is kind of weird because I want to be considerate, but I don't have anything that automatically that I know off the top of my head that will just like get me to like X card.
Mm-hmm.
But this is the first game where I can actually experience the need for it.
Mm-hmm.
And so, because the last couple ones we played were mostly just a little like.
Fun, yeah. Games.
But this one
thanks
is.
Thanks for that follow.
Yeah, but this is great. So now I actually get to experience the real necessity
of why you would need the X card.
Yeah, it's really cool.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I love the X card because it lets us do games like this. It lets us push farther than we would if we didn't have the thing to help with boundaries.
I'm sorry, she just made the soundtrack vaporwave.
Wait, so it's like 80s music?
It sounds like
early
90s commercials.
Distorted.
It sounds yeah. Yeah. Come on.
I also cool like
roots.
I'm gonna Google this when I get home.
So for me, the thing that was really interesting about this, and I'm gonna have like a gender conversation
do
for
it.
Like a minute.
Oh no.
So not to call out Ajit on the first day where I was like, and you know, I've now put Bluebeard in the place that I put all men in my brain where I don't trust them.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw him do the like, what? Face for a minute, and I saw all of us go, yep. And that's not something that I see in games much, where it really is like, this is called feminine horror because it's something that women and femme-presenting people really experience, like, in society and in their day-to-day lives, and it has all this fantasy stuff, but like, when you're like, I'm helpless in this situation and no one believes me, that's something that happens.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that it's very interesting to put that in a place where people of all genders can really
have to
experience it. Yeah. And in a place where then people that have experienced it understand it better and can freak other people out with it. That's really cool to me. So there's my gender conversation.
That's awesome. Fantastic.
Kind of coming off of that as well. One thing, I actually didn't know the term feminine horror before you started using it in reference to Bluebeard's Bride,
really?
Which is kind of surprising because in learning what it is, I've learned that I've been a fan of it for quite some time.
Yeah, same.
Like I went to go see Crimson Peak and want to see it many times.
Thanks for that.
But yeah, so I have really enjoyed learning that this is a genre and, you know, the conventions of that. It just, I don't know, it wasn't even a thing that occurred to me as being a thing.
But it's awesome, right?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Have you read Jane Eyre?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, no, see, this is why, and like, these are the things, like, I have been a fan of this for a long time, I just didn't know it had a name. Like Bleed, you name all of these things for me that I had no idea existed, but I have known existed for a long time.
Strix can teach you a lot of stuff.
You learn so much on this show, you guys. If you want to ask a question,
please ask.
That's why we're here. I want to talk about Bleed in a second, but first I want to give you guys a chance to share top of mind thoughts if you have any.
I think I've shared most of the stuff.
I did have something I wanted to say, but I don't remember what it was. So let's really use this right now.
Cool. So then let's talk about Bleed a little bit.
Yeah, let's talk about Bleed.
Did anybody have Bleed? I did. So because the subject matter is so much about a gendered experience of being in the world, there's almost all of it was like, yep, talking about me, this is my life. I mean, obviously not this, but like, experiencing these things in a container and being able to be like, that thing, was really interesting to me, and I definitely had some lead out from the game to my real self. Mm-hmm. So that was really interesting, and I think kind of normal for this game. I think this is a game that promotes bleed.
Can I answer Yipley's question?
Yeah, what was the question?
I believe Yipley is asking if I'm trans, and the answer is I'm non-binary, AFAB, and I consider myself in the trans umbrella. So, good job catching all of my signals in our secret language. I'm very proud. They, them pronouns. It's cool, though.
Oh, awesome. We need to hang out.
I know.
Yeah. The studio's real cool.
Oh my goodness.
I think I brought it up before, but the bleed moments for me were, my character was very much not myself, but I had lots of moments where I'm like, why am I doing these things? Uh-huh. Is it like anger at the fact that she's been placed in this situation? Like what the hell is going on?
Definitely, especially with the scarab and like, turn it inward or turn it outward, and you chose to turn it outward. That was very, it was a very impactful and large moment, so that was super cool.
It's like we all knew that we had to do it. Mm-hmm. Like, and nobody wanted to, all had to in order to stop all of us from shattering.
Because mm-hmm. For those of you who were not keeping track as stringently as like, I know some people in chat were saying, oh my God, is she about to shatter? And I still had to, points left I could blow.
But we were definitely in a room at one point where we had four each.
Yes.
Yeah.
We were like getting out of that room without all of us shattering required us engaging in some magical thinking to trick out a token of faithfulness from that last room where we took that last faithfulness token.
Yeah, so as the designer of the game, I have to say we make that pressure very specific, where you know it's the wrong choice, but you have to convince yourself that this token is right, because otherwise you die. It is a very uncomfortable feeling, and I'm so glad to see that it worked exactly how it was supposed to.
You can't just bounce into a room, be like, token of disloyalty, token of disloyalty, token of disloyalty, all done. Like, you have to play both sides, because you're going to take trauma in every room, so that's really cool.
And even taking the healing changes your character, because she talked herself into this. Like, it changed the Fatale a bit to like, oh, he sent this as our friend. Like, what does that mean? He chose you to be, oh, goodness gracious.
Yep, it's kind of a mindfuck.
Yeah. Yes. This whole game.
So we need to get to affirmations. Yeah. Okay, about 10 minutes.
Yeah, I just looked up
before
the screen.
They like just cut off the camera on us.
Oh my goodness!
So just so you guys know in chat, I feel like I need to tell you we are going to do additional debriefing off camera because I want to make sure that everyone is cool. This is important because no matter what we're doing on the show, like the show comes second to everybody's comfort and safety and health. So we'll be checking in off camera some more. And I'm just telling you that because I want you to have realistic expectations of what this kind of play looks like. So, I had a fabulous fucking time!
Woo! Yay!
And I hope you guys did too, and we're gonna end this on a positive note. Like Yay. You do, because we probably need those affirmations.
Oh yes.
So, the first set of affirmations is for Cheryl and Liz, and it is from Muhledale.
Aw, thank you, Mal! Yeah.
So, let me grab these cards back out here. And maybe we can get a sick anteater.
Oh,
la 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 la.
Oh, my goodness.
All right, you two. You are magnificent, shouting koalas.
What do we do?
Ears, guys. Ears,
yes,
ears. Careful. Oh, ears.
Okay.
We did it.
Dear God, teamwork makes the dream work.
I love where you went with the ears. That was the nicest ending.
All right, this one. Oh, this one is for Negihama, one of our mods. Negihama is recovering from surgery. And this is from Erslyn. So, I didn't know you were having surgery, but I'm glad that it went okay. I hope you recover swiftly. And this is really cool. I hope you feel affirmed. So, Negihama, you are a silly, behaving sphinx. So I feel like that would be like, meow, meow, meow.
Oh, there we go. Liz is believing. Don't stop believing, sphinx.
Yeah, thank you for the reset.
Yeah.
Okay, the next one is for Undead War 43. This was a new sub while we were playing.
Yeah.
Strix thought. Strix Fact 412, Strix is the only woman to use the small key and live to tell the tale. That's how the fairy tale of Bluebeard came into existence.
Bluebeard.
Does he have a first name?
Totally different.
Can we call him Linus Beard? Linus Bluebeard?
No, we're calling him Linus.
I enjoyed that Strix Fact.
Strix Fact. She does not like the name Linus.
All right, Undead War, thank you for joining the Thumper family. You came out on a really interesting note. We hope that you enjoyed it. And you are an elegant, prancing ifrit. Miss Lizzie, what does an elegant, prancing ifrit sound like?
I don't even know what an ifrit is.
It's like a djinn.
Like a fiery.
Fiery.
Okay, elegant and prancing. I'm going to, you said a djinn, they're like genies, right?
Ish.
Ish?
Fiery.
Okay, this is a very lovely painting. I'm very elegant in my silks and they're on fire. I really, you know what?
I made a specimen of
this is how I
want to
remember you from now on.
This is the hidden room is monologuing. I love it.
Skinny silks.
Drugsy free.
I did dance for you.
This is why we have affirmations.
Thank you, PWJB. You know my DMX impression is awesome. Thank you.
All right, the next one is for...
Why, Lady Kaku? Why?
Oh, Lady Kaku! Yes!
On it!
Thank you for that amazing cider, too, last week.
I'm trying so hard, Lizzie. Thank you, FF. I appreciate you, too.
Bless.
Bless.
All right, the next affirmation is for Erg. Or Erg.
Erg.
You are confident, entertaining raven.
Hello, my baby. Hello, my baby.
You were so confident.
Oh my god.
Bless that was actually perfect.
Like, how are you so good on both sides? Like, you're like, this is my very serious time now in this horror game. And then you're like, yeah. And they're both so good.
Oh yeah.
Bits.
Acting.
All right, the next one is for Prosperous Guard, who treated us to such lovely limericks.
So
Prosperous Guard, you are a handsome, buzzing centaur. So I think we probably should do this one together. So someone's gonna be like the hooves.
I'll be the buzzing.
Okay, and someone's gonna
be
like
the horses. They have like
an arrow
or something.
Yeah,
right?
It's like...
We'll do hooves so it's four legs.
Yeah. Okay. That was pretty good.
Centaur.
Team effort.
That was a good team effort, Centaur.
Pretty good.
All right, the next one is for Bam Fails, and this was for the sandwiches,
as you call them.
Oh, thanks for the bits, Alien Nutter. No full cup.
Oh no, I missed the cup.
You missed it.
Two full cups. I was so ready.
All right, Bam Fails, thank you for joining us on this very spooky day. You are a glamorous, misbehaving, Kelpie.
Ooh.
A glamorous misbehaving Kelpie.
Here comes up. Oh, it missed again.
Oh no.
You open a door. There is a cup. I've been constantly falling to the sides of the cup. What do you choose?
It's the worst.
Are the bits the scarab shattered? Yeah.
Mel.
Yes. I'm sorry, I'm watching these bits. Just
but what is a glamorous misbehaving Kelpie?
Glamorous misbehaving Kelpie
is
like, my hair is fabulous, but I'm going to TP your house.
I have bad water. Shotgun time.
Oh!
Is the cup half empty or is it half full?
Half full thanks to Alien Knitter.
That's super awesome.
I think he was trying to go for it empty.
Well, all the gray ones are gone. Now there's more room.
Witness.
All right, the next one is from Krellen, and it's for us, because we need the affirmation after that game, even though I feel pretty good. So we are all flamboyant, burrowing sharktopuses.
Woo! Oh my god.
So it's a woo!
Barbara! Come back! I love you!
I think this is it. I got it.
That's the one.
Oh, Mr. Owl. Bits are raining down. Check it out.
Love them bits.
Check them bits.
Okay, our last sub for the day was Misty Twyla? I'm not very good at pronouncing these names, so if you want to tell me how it's actually pronounced, I'm always looking in chat. I do lurt. But thank you so much for subbing. We super appreciate it. Subs and donations are how we stay on the air. It's how we have shows like this. So this is entirely community supported. Thank you guys so much. So, Misty, you are a gregarious, achieving sea lion. I think we all have to do this one together too. Yeah. Are you ready? That kind of sea lion. I got it.
I like that.
And on that note, folks, we're out of time.
Next carded.
It was a wonderful show. Thank you so much for joining us. Again, my name is Strix. I'm the host of this show, Weekly Affirmations. It's on every week on Thursdays at 6 p.m. Next week, we'll be playing a new game. I'm not telling you what it is yet. Joining us today was Drunkly Romantic, Cheryl, Lizzie, and Mel. You can type who exclamation point to find out all of the relevant information. But Laura QQ, can you outro us with our theme song, please?
Oh, I said a Weekly Affirmations, a positive feel-good show. Most positive thing on this channel called Hypo Rabbit Power Go.
Which says something decent about this channel.
Thank you, everyone. You're lovely. Good night.
Cheers.
Go back to Kickstarter.
Yeah.
Yay.
Yeah, go back.